I'm Alan Partridge, and this is Mid Morning Matters.
North Norfolk Digital.
You're listening to North Norfolk Digital. It's time to
focus on
cycling. I am in the studio with Jim Jones. Hello. Now, just to clear something up, you're not the Jim Jones who led a mass suicide in the Jonestown massacre by feeding his followers poisoned broth.
Of course not.
Glad to hear it. Well, look, you'd be dead, wouldn't you, along with your 900 followers. Do you ever have dark thoughts?
No, not really.
If you're tuning in to us without the aid of visual internet, let me fill you in. Jim is astride a static exercise cycle. Why?
Well, I'm running a campaign called On Your Bike. It's about getting young kids out and on the cycle.
Can you stop? Can you stop cycling now? Because the noise, I didn't realise it was going to make that noise. A bit distracting. You're listening to North Norfolk Digital, North Norfolk's best music mix. If you are watching the internet from a third world country, perhaps you're unfamiliar with bikes, cycling is a form of wheeled transportation whereby the legs are used as pistons to propel the cyclist forward.
Exactly.
Sounds complicated.
It's not. This campaign's bang on simple. Basically, we're trying to empower kids.
No, I'm just going to interrupt you there. Jim, I've just got an email and it says that in the Jonestown massacre, it wasn't soup he made them drink, it was actually poisoned Kool-Aid. So just to reiterate, the fluid administered by the Reverend Jim Jones in the Jonestown massacre in Guyana in 1978 to just under 1,000 innocent men, women and children was pop, not broth. So that's pop, not broth.
So this campaign's about helping kids that are a wee bit overweight shed a few pounds.
Ever met a child the size of an ox?
Pardon?
The reason I mention it is I once knew a man who was the size of an ox, but with the mind of a child. He was a very affable chap, helped me move house. Yeah, didn't like loud noises, but my goodness, he could eat.
I spend time with these kids and I end up learning from them.
Really?
Yeah, I end up relating to them as adults.
Right.
You spend time alone with these children, you end up being a big kid yourself.
Yeah. You've been cleared to work with children, haven't
Absolutely.
You? Yeah, okay. So all the boxes ticked and you're on the register. The good one, the good one.
Yeah.
Great. Sorry to have to broach that subject, but you know, it's an awful business, but we've had some cracking phone-ins about it. But, you know, it is an ongoing problem, especially round these parts, if you get my drift.
What, in the radio station?
No, he's gone.
This is about educating kids into being fit. I took them on a long cycle ride. We cycled from Land's End to John O'Groats, a group of 11 to 12-year-olds.
I'm planning on doing the very same journey myself next year.
You're going from Land's End to John O'Groats on a bicycle?
No, in a Toyota Avensis.
Who's sponsoring you?
No one. It's just one of the great UK drives, along with clockwise and anti-clockwise around the M25 in the same day, which I did manage last year when I had a day to kill. I was dismissed from jury service. They wanted an ethnic balance, and I was the fool guy! It was just a Japanese saloon car. Me and the very best of Deacon Blue.
Did you enjoy yourself?
Well, I'm asking the questions.
Great, Alan. Fine, ask away.
I will. I'll ask you one in a second. This is North Norfolk Digital, sustaining and maintaining our core listenership in an increasingly fragmented marketplace.
North.
Just realised I read that from an internal memo. Wasn't for you to hear. Sorry. Today we're talking condiments. You're stuck on a desert island. You're allowed one condiment. Which is it to be? John in Sproston.
Ketchup.
Harry in Bodham.
Mustard.
Kev in Norwich.
Gravy.
That's not a condiment. It's a hot sauce.
A pistol then.
That's a brand of gravy.
Bronson pickle, then.
And that's a relish. It's 12:08 in less than 1 hour.
Mustard.
Myself and sidekick Simon...
Man the barricades.
...will come face to face with one of the most beautiful women in the world.
Anthea Turner.
Anthea the Body Turner.
Ooh. You like her, do you, then, Alan?
What man doesn't? Seriously, what band doesn't?
Oh, no, hardly any.
Exactly. She...
Stevie Wonder.
or Ray Charles.
Any blind man.
Yeah. She is the Ford Escort Cabriolet of middle-aged women. Sleek, petite, a little bit racy.
0% finance available.
It doesn't even make sense. But it's still funny. It's still surreally funny. Which is why we booked you.
Power steering.
I gotta say, it's always like this, isn't it?
It is.
We had brunch.
I had lunch
on Sunday. You had lunch. What do you call lunch and brunch when they're combined? What's the
blunch? Is it a blunch?
That's excellent. Really good. What did you order?
I had the Thai fish cakes.
Yeah, that's right. No, tell me what I had. I had the... I can't remember. You're listening to North Norfolk Digital with Alan Partridge. Anthea Turner coming up in half an hour. I hope she didn't hear that. Jim Jones, in the meantime, I have a little surprise for you. It's this award for services to the larger child. It's an Al Ha, Alan's Local Hero Award. It's not engraved. You do that yourself, put what you like. For those of you who don't have the webcam, it's a mock brass hand doing that. So you can take that, show it to the kids. Actually, don't. Just take it straight home. Did that get on your nerves, being surrounded by all those puffing, wheezing kids?
Oh, well, actually, Alan, these kids are pretty active. I mean, they could cycle 10 miles, 30 minutes.
I could cycle 10 miles in 30 minutes. I could cycle 30 miles in 10 minutes.
That'd be 180 miles an hour.
All right, I couldn't do that. But I could do the easier one that you said first.
10 miles in 30 minutes?
Yes.
Be my guest?
I will be your guest, even though technically you're my guest. Dismount, Reverend Jim Jones. This is live radio, no time like the present. I, Alan Partridge, am going to attempt to cycle 10 miles in 30 minutes. But first, Wizard. I'm joined by Tommy Gaskell, who is a survival and a naturalist expert. Tommy, have you yourself ever been, to coin a phrase, up the creek without a paddle?
Yes. Well, you mean I've been in trouble in the wilderness a few times, but if you are up a creek without a paddle, then you should think laterally because there are always paddles around you. The solution to many problems in the wilderness are in the immediate vicinity.
Right. That chimes very much with me. It takes me back to 74 when I was walking in the Chilterns, and that year the nettles were particularly virulent, and that's where my story begins, because I fell into some nettles. My knees gave way after what I can only describe as a very, very long walk. I said to my colleagues, "You go on without me, leave me be." They said, "Ape, we ain't going nowhere without you."
Ape,
Alan Partridge abbreviation. They said, "We are not going to go anywhere without you." And they're some of the most principled scouts who I have ever rambled with.
So what did you do?
I can spot a dockleaf from 30 feet.
Well, that's great. So you use the natural flora around you as an antidote.
As an antidote. Do you ever find there's any kind of serenity in the wild and windy moors?
There was a particularly nasty incident once. I was in Afghanistan with my men hanging off a cliff face in dense, freezing fog, waiting for this fog to disperse for about 3 hours. And I felt incredibly at peace. That's what nature can do for you, I think.
Yeah. So, you were in Afghanistan, was that on holiday with some mates, or you actually...
No, I was in the forces.
Yeah, of course. I mean, that makes more sense.
Which force? Parcel force?
Yeah, I have some respect. I mean, special forces. I'm correct, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, OK. You must have some very interesting stories about clearing insurgent Talibans from the caves of Tora Bora.
Well, with respect, I'm just here to talk about survival in the outdoors. I'd rather not go into counterinsurgency techniques or classified operations of any kind. Specifically not about the Torabora caves.
OK, all right. I'm just very interested to hear about hand-to-hand combat, which I am told took place. Pretty ugly stuff, but I know sometimes... But OK, well, let's talk hypothetically. Didn't say the caves don't necessarily have to be Torabora.
So where are they, then?
Cheddar Gorge.
So the Taliban have come over to Cheddar Gorge?
Not necessarily the Taliban. Could be a radicalised homegrown terrorist cell.
Like?
The RSPB.
I'm pretty sure that the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds is non-violent.
At the moment, they're not violent. But what if we kicked it up a notch? Let's paint a scenario. The last osprey in Britain is killed by a football. The last osprey egg is stolen and scrambled for a Russian oligarch's breakfast, who eats it without one iota of remorse in his leather jacket, simply wipes his lips and says, simples.
Where are you going with this?
Bear with me. So rare birds' eggs are being scrambled for Russian oligarchs, and Bill Oddie goes apeshit. He shows up at Claridge's wearing his twitchers jerkin and the pockets are full of every conceivable explosive.
I got the picture.
He walks in to the buffet area, the breakfast buffet. People turn round. They say, isn't that the man from Springwatch? Someone else says, wasn't he once one of the goodies? Yeah, not anymore. Now he's a baddie. Seconds later, carnage. Oddie is like a bearded Catherine wheel scything through the crowd. Ironically, the oligarchs wearing the leather jackets are protected from the worst of the blast, but an innocent couple from the northeast on a city break are vaporised.
Sorry, are you asking me a specific question?
Yes.
And that question is if an RSPB neo-fundamentalist was radicalised... Yeah. Oddie sacrificed himself.
Yeah.
The rest of them holed up in Wookiee Hole and I was sent to neutralise the threat.
Yeah.
How would I proceed?
Simples.
Really want to know?
Yeah. Let's hear it. Hand-to-hand combat, commando style.
Do you mind if I stand up?
No, please.
Take the floor.
The floor is yours. You have the floor.
So, in Special Forces, we're given licence to use bespoke techniques, improvised weaponry, that sort of thing. My favourite for hand-to-hand combat is this brass knuckle, which I've adapted. I've stuck a protruding blade on one side, very sharp. What I would do is, when I'd attack the first insurgent, punch him full in the face as hard as I could until I felt the splinter of bone, that his nose was truly shattered, and then, as he's toppling backwards, grab hold of him with your right hand and bring my hand back with the blade like an arc across his throat, severing one or preferably both of the carotid arteries. If you get it right, the neck opens up completely, yawns back like a Muppet's mouth.
Oh, my God.
So then you let them drop. Take care not to trip over them. I've seen that happen. And then you repeat and adapt. 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 Until the cave is clear. It's very bloody, but it's quick, and it's quiet. And that's why I like it. Any questions?
No.
Yeah, which Muppet?
Simon, do you think Anthea Turner cycles?
I don't know.
I know, but do you think she cycles?
I don't know, I've never given it any thought.
Well, think about it now. Do you think she cycles?
Yes, I think she probably does.
Yeah, I do. I think she probably rides one of those big Dutch bikes with a basket and a bell, and she'd cycle along in a flimsy cotton dress with the sun and the breeze in her hair. She'd just discard the bike by the side of the road, find a nice spot in the field, and lay down on a tartan blanket with a copy of Grazia, a thermos flask, and a big jam sandwich. Maybe a beef paste cob. Heaven.
course, you'd have to watch out for combine harvesters. Slice through it like a hot knife through butter.
Oh, but what lovely butter.
Oh, yes.
Lightly salted.
Okay, take it easy. Just take it easy. No, it's not going to be a shame. All right, a lot of these kids are very fit.
Hang on, you're from Northern Ireland?
Yeah.
Is it better now that the troubles are over? Yeah?
Of course.
Yeah, good. I like the murals on the end of the houses. Pictures of Mary Balaclavas. Tommy guns. It's, must be like living amongst an artist like Banksy. But, you know, lots of Banksys. But Banksys who want to kill people who live near them.
Alan.
Yeah.
It's Anthea.
Oh, Christ! Yeah. I wanted to have a shower before she got here. I bought my wash bag in especially. Some smints. Go get me a towel. Go get me a towel! Anthea, how are you?
Hiya.
Just been cycling. North Norfolk Digital. You rejoin us on Mid-Morning Matters. Tommy Gaskell, survival expert, still with us. And on line two, we have Sophie. Sophie, what's your tongue twister? No, love, he didn't hurt any Muppets. He simply dispatched some terrorists from a radicalised RSPB in Wookiee Hole. It was simply that when he slit the throats of the bad people, they resembled the mouths of Muppets. Hope that answers.
Did they get better?
We cleared the cave.
No one survived, Sophie. He cleared the cave. Did you feel bad?
It's my job.
No, he didn't feel bad, Sophie.
Did the man get into trouble?
No, because the government allows him to kill people. Sometimes, when the government's exhausted diplomatic means, they allow state-sanctioned killing. Sometimes you have to when you grow up, you'll realise that sometimes you have to tackle tough Taliban terrorists to topple totalitarian tyrants. That was a bit of a tongue twister, wasn't it? No, Bin Laden's alive and well, Sophie. Well, he's alive. All right, cheerio, Sophie. Thanks very much, Tommy, for being on the show. Fascinating stuff. Loved your wise words. Interestingly, Tommy's the first person we've had on North Norfolk Digital who's killed someone deliberately. We all know, of course, of Simon Pickering from Travel, who reversed over a nurse, which was an accident, so he says. This is the Simon Park Orchestra with Eye Level, otherwise known as the theme from Van der Vork. Hello, you're joining me, Alan Partridge, on Mid-Morning Matters. I'm here with my sidekick, Simon.
Hello, Alan.
SS, as I like to call him. Sieg Heil.
Sieg Heil.
Sieg Heil. And we're asking, which band names would you like to become reality? Simon, what you got?
I have got an email from Carl, who says he longs for a crowded house as his wife and kids have recently left him.
That's a lovely one, that.
That's
marvellous.
Nice. And I've also got a text from an Adrian H., whose wife, Elizabeth, suffers from a pituitary gland problem, so he would like to see Thin Lizzy.
Sure he would.
Slightly pie in the sky.
Yeah, probably where he'd like the pie to remain, actually.
Out of harm's way.
Out of reach of his...
greedy guts wife.
Yeah, well, she's not greedy, she's got a problem.
Pituitary gland problem, of course.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's a bank holiday, which traditionally would have been you've been in a car on the way to the seaside with a Lilo, a dog full of sand, some hard-boiled Werther's Originals,
yeah,
or whatever. But these days, unfortunately, it's more likely to mean a child watching a violent computer game and pornography while shouting, "I hate you!" to his parents who are downstairs having a cocaine and ecstasy-fueled orgy. That's Britain 2011. You're welcome to it. But sorry, I'm getting a bit negative there. But to lighten the mood, we are having a tongue twister phone in where we invite little kiddies to ring in and attempt to say complex sentences with their underdeveloped mouths. Time for some music. Yes, sirree. There's no point yelling at that large spotted cat who's dragging the lifeless body of an apprentice zookeeper across the compound. He won't be able to hear you. He's a deaf leopard.
Brilliant. Turn it up, Norfolk.
North Norfolk. On line one, we have Emily. Hello, lovey. What's your tongue twister?
Ooh, I'll
take this one.
Right, hang on. Now that's a riddle. That's not a tongue twister.
No good.
We're doing tongue twisters. We're quite specific about that. You shouldn't have been put through. Who put you through?
I don't know.
Was it a woman who smokes too much? Does she sound like she had too many fags?
It was a lady.
Mommy. Oh, sod it.
Useless.
Yeah. Parents, if you're going to get your under sevens, which is specifically what this is for. Who are off school today, if you're going to get them to call in the radio station, it's A, tongue twister, not a riddle, and B, can you please make sure they are reasonably media savvy? That's the only point I wanted to make.
Towel.
What?
Towel. The, what gets wet as it dries. Towel.
I still think I was right to cut her off.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. You're listening to North Norfolk Digital with Alan Partridge and my sidekick Simon.
And, Alan, one of my spies tells me that you were dining in a certain gastropub last night.
I did have dinner at the Boxley Wheat Chief, I can't deny.
Yes, and a little bird tells me that you were not dining alone. A friend of yours?
None of your business, mate. Right, now, extinction. We're talking animals.
Well, we're not talking animals.
No. All right, we're not talking animals, no. Although the woman who does the weather is, if the graffiti in the men's toilets is to be believed.
Steady, Alan.
it's all right. I've not mentioned her by name. There are two of them. Yeah. And anyway, I'm sure it's not true, because what I read it was pretty awful, actually. No one should have to read that.
And I'm sure she won't. It's in the men's.
Exactly. And if she does go in the men's, maybe it's true. Just to be clear, we're taking calls on the question, if you could make one species of animal extinct, which would it be and how would you do it? Thanks. We've got a Steve from Swaffham emails to say, I would make all flightless birds extinct by putting the world's bird seed on a shelf that's slightly too high for them to reach, thereby starving them to death. Thanks, Steve. We also have a fax here. Thank you. A fax from Callum, aged 9, who's depicted his method of execution. And to describe it, it's kind of the Battersea power station lying on its side with the chimneys acting as flamethrowers, wiping out the world's population of chimpanzees. And one of them's got a little bubble there saying, oh, God, please, no, don't burn us. There it is. Very good, that is, too. And finally, we have a text from Ted in Fakenham, which simply says, cats, hammers. Good. I like her face. She has a very round, cherubic face, rather like a Victorian doll that's somehow been reanimated. But, no, say what you like about Billy Piper, but she is the most popular prostitute on ITV.
North Norfolk Digital, North Norfolk's best music mix.
You're listening to AP on Treble M, i.e. Alan Partridge on Mid-Morning Matters. This morning in...
Simply the best of Norfolk.
We're asking you to tell us who is simply the best person Norfolk has ever produced. And for those of you who are interested...
Simply the Best of Norfolk is an original concept devised and executed by Alan Partridge and North Norfolk Digital. It has no affiliation with, similarity to, or obligation towards BBC One's 2002 programme, 100 Greatest Britons. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan. We're asking you to tell us who is simply the best person Norfolk's ever produced. I think you would imagine that Horatio Nelson and Oliver Cromwell are going to be somewhere on that list. A better example would be Jeremiah Coleman, founder of the Coleman's Mustard Empire. Not only was he responsible for the world's hottest yellow paste, but he also helped create the phrase, ooh, that's mustard, which means, ooh, that's very good. It's still favoured, although it's an olden day phrase, still favoured by men over 70 who wear blazers. Whereas young people today may well say things like radical, awesome, mega. If a young person were to see Wayne Rooney driving along with his wife or a sexy hooker in a bling-bling car, they may well say, "Oh, look, Rain Wooney, top one." Whereas in Edwardian times, a young Cockney, if he were to see the Duke of Norfolk driving along in a horse's carriage or a French panard with his wife, the Duchess of Norfolk, who was perhaps wearing a dress revealing a little bit too much ankle, may well have shouted out, "Oh, did you see her ankle? I did. I seen all of it. Mustard!" Like that.
And a spokesman for the Norfolk Health Authority said building on the ward would be completed by early 2012. And finally, a correction. While Alan was right to say that a typhoon is approaching Norfolk, it's actually heading to the American town of Norfolk, Virginia. The weather in East Anglia should be fine and dry, so slightly misleading there. That's all for me. I'll be back in 30.
He means minutes.
What's that?
You said 30, failed to specify the unit. You may have meant years. Bit misleading.
I'll be back in 30 years.
Ideally, yes.
Can I tell you what, Alan, if I'm still...
You're listening to North Norfolk Digital, North Norfolk's best music mix. I'm joined by my comedic chum, Sidekick Simon. Good morning.
Morning.
What do you got for us today?
I've got a number of ribald rib ticklers for your delight and delectation.
He's going to be doing some jokes. It's Monday morning.
No! No!
I know the feeling, I do. But cheer up, me old mate, because today on Love Luncheon, we're going to be throwing a little bit of light on the topic of English wine. What could be better than curling up on your favourite sofa, kicking off your shoes and socks, and sharing an expensive bottle of wine with the woman in your life? Or the man in your life, if you're a woman.
Or the man in your life, if you're gay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, yes. I will be the first to hold my hands up and say... In the past, circa 1983, I developed a fairly robust dislike for the gay community. But that was before I met Dale Winton. And I realised I had absolutely nothing to worry about. The man was a perfect gentleman. I actually spent 3 days at the Earl's Court Boat Show with Dale Winton and Paul O'Grady and Noel Edmonds. He's not gay, but you get the picture.
I was going to say, Noel Edmonds always reminds me of a garden gnome.
You know, if you told me... 25 years ago, that I was going to be talking about rigid inflatable hulls with Dale Winton, I would probably have spat at you. Got any jokes about gays?
I have got a joke about gays. Do you want me to read it?
No, God, absolutely not. You can't read it. I mean, it's very funny, but it's quite hateful. Psychic Simon. You're listening to North Norfolk Digital, music and chat for the North Norfolk generation. It's time is 12:00 midday. This is Chat Down, street style for the over 40s. You'll recall that at the top of the show, someone phoned in to say that you can avoid type 2 diabetes by injecting yourself with Ribena. That can't be right, but no one as yet has called in to debunk that. If you want to, please do so. Now, as we reach the halfway mark, just time for one more call. Line 5.
Hello.
Where are you calling from?
Holt.
Excellent. Are you over 40?
Just...
I'll take that as a yes. It's rude to ask, but I now and again, just to sort of... We'd like to check the demographic, and... are you over 40? Can you just tell me seriously if you are?
Well,
are you over 40?
Yes, I'm just over 40, yes.
Good. Well, there's nothing wrong with that. I'm well over 40. But I've still got all my, faculties. If that's not too strong a word. Come on. Were you calling from Holt?
Yes, I'm calling from Holt.
Lovely part of the world. Lovely part of the world. I spent many a happy hour there in my youth. Marvellous part of the world. I mean, I didn't live there, but I would occasionally go there because I knew a girl but then I stopped seeing her, so I stopped going there. But what was the point you wanted to make?
Well, I just wanted to say that I don't think people should be voting for Oliver Cromwell.
Why?
Because he slaughtered thousands of Irish peasants.
Well, we've all got our black spots on our curriculum vitae. We'd rather not...
Well, I don't think I have got any black spots.
Come on, Jill. You're from Holt. You're from Holt, Jill.
Uncle Judith.
Yeah, take a chill pill, Jill.
Uncle Judith.
What?
Judith, my name's Judith.
Yeah, right. Sorry, Judith. Well, you are the Rudith, Judith. The other thing to... Sorry, what? Just tell me your favourite Norfolk person.
Social reformer Elizabeth Fry.
Thank you. She's gone now. Delighted to say that we have here from the British Wine Marketing Board, Rosie Witter. Lovely to have you here, Rosie.
It's lovely to be here, thank you.
So what are you going to start us off with?
Right, well, we're going to ease you in today, Alan, with a Merlot, which, believe it or not, is actually produced in Surrey. Mm. Now, this is a very versatile wine.
Right, now, when you say versatile wine, what other uses can wine have apart from drinking?
Well, it means it can be drunk in many situations.
Ah, right. So, with some friends alongside Spag Bol. On your own in front of Newsnight?
If you like, yeah.
At the launch of Sterling Moss's autobiography?
Certainly.
It's that versatile. Really, that sounds like a very good wine. I like that wine. What else have
you
got?
Do you want to taste it?
Yeah, sure, why not?
So, the way to drink wine...
Well, I think I know how to drink wine, Rosie. I'll drink you under the table.
Well, I'm sure you could.
Sorry, continue. Stop. I don't drink to excess.
Right, so, well, first of all, you swill the wine gently, and this just allows it to breathe.
Oxygenates the
yes,
wine.
Yes, that's right.
I've known that for a while.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm very impressed. And then you smell it.
Mm-hmm.
So...
For the bouquet.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I'm semi-conversant.
Yes. I'll give it a sniff.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's deep. You all right?
Have a smell.
Oh. Right. Have you not got another glass? You had your nose in this. I'm only kidding. You've got a lovely nose.
Stick it right in.
Right. Yeah, I was slightly hyperventilating then. Used to lead to lead to panic attacks. Jesus, not now. Whew.
What were you getting?
A panic attack. Oh no, the bouquet. It's been a while since I've used, you know, wine words.
Oh well, people use all sorts of words to describe wine. I mean, you know, vanilla, melon, straw.
Surely only livestock know what straw tastes like.
It's just a hint.
Yeah, it's just a hint.
And with red wines.
Yeah, wines have hints. Yeah.
Have a go, Alan. What did you get from that?
Pepper?
Yes!
Really?
Yes, really?
That is a very very peppery wine. Lots of pepper, lots of pepper. Yeah, I didn't even have to think of it. As soon as it brought to my nose, bang, pepper. Amazing.
Well, you've got a good nose.
Like you. What's next? That's a very now that's very familiar. Yes. Now that's what is it?
Currants.
No. It's very specific.
Mm. Well, it's musky, so.
No. It's.
Berries?
No, the Rosie. That's wrong.
Sorry. It's cherry. Cinnamon.
No, this wine tastes of Chewit.
Oh, well, I've never heard of Chewit.
Have we got any Chewit? This tea taste of chicken. Davin, this tea taste of chicken. This tea tastes of chicken. Can I taste of chicken?
It's just normal tea, man.
Well, hang on. I've just eaten some chicken. That's the bones. We've had a text from Pete in Blackheath. He suggests that Norfolk's best person ever is Egyptologist Howard Carter. Without Carter's discovery of Tutankhamun's tomb, archaeology, which is now what it's known as, would simply be known as digging, or digging for things. And of course, without Howard Carter, there wouldn't be programmes such as The Time Team, which is a horrific thought. And these days, they can use computers to reanimate a dead Saxon and tell you exactly what he had for pudding before he was murdered with a blunt instrument in the year 5. I met Tony Robinson at 10 Years of Time Team. Lovely fella. I joked with him. I said, Tony, if you live by the bog axe, you die by the bog axe. He chuckled a little to himself before he said, I best go and mingle. And he just wandered off. Lovely fella, although I don't like his politics. The time team is 2-2-2-2. I'm serious. I'm not joking. It's actually 2-2-2. It is 2-2-2-2. Right, that's enough tease. I'm going to do the rest of the programme without any tease. No, it's too complicated. But we'll revisit that next week. Good idea. See how we get along with it. See how far we get with that. I've got to interview Charlene Spiteri. So I could just call her Charlene from Texas. No, that's another T. Charlene from Exus. That'll be... might not do that. Now, before I tie a belt round your upper arm, slap your vein and inject you with a pure dose of Genesis, I have to say I am being harangued into throwing my own hat into the ring for Norfolk's greatest person. So in I go. This is unbelievable. How Delia Smith can be within one vote of Horatio Nelson, it really is beyond me. If you want to vote for a food-related hero, may I suggest Turkey Baron Bernard Matthews. Bernard slays, I know this because he's a friend of mine, close to 7 million turkeys a year, which is doing for about the best part of 30 years. He has slaughtered close to 250 million birds for your eating pleasure. Not personally, of course, the process is highly mechanised. No, Bernard's not actually wrung the neck of a turkey for a couple of years, and even then it was for a charity event. It's great to be around him. Depending on your point of view, he's either responsible for the biggest ornithological genocide of recent times, or he is the greatest farmyard-to-table strategist of the last 100 years. And I know this for a fact because he is my confidant, he's tantalisingly close to producing the 10-pence turkey. What a thought. He's actually shown me around his factory recently. He very, very liberal of him. He said, you can go anywhere you like, Alan. Apart from one room, he just stood in front of my path and said, don't go in there. I said, I thought you said I could go anywhere. He just said, just drop it. And all the love went from his eyes. Chilling. Anyway, I'd like to suggest Bernard Matthews as Norfolk's greatest person, along with my own hat, which is still in the ring, along with all the other candidates' hats.
Now, this Chardonnay from Devon is exceptionally well-balanced.
Rosie, it's great. They're all great. Fantastic.
Nicely fruity with a long finish.
Yeah, it's... What does that mean?
Well,
long finish.
It means the taste lingers on the palate.
It does. It lingers on the palate, absolutely.
Like a lazy forklift truck driver. He would linger on the palate.
No, yeah. Oh. Yeah. Not bad. Keep talking.
Well, so it lingers on the palate, mm-hmm. And the taste, therefore, will...
Sorry,
you all right?
Yeah, that's just the thing. Oh. There we go.
Just...
No problem. Just... Go on, so what are you saying?
So is that taste lingering for you?
Yeah. Yeah, I can still taste it. Definitely, yeah. Yeah, still there.
Well, you will. You will for some time.
Yeah, it's got a... Still there.
Yeah.
I mean, we can't wait till the flavour goes before we carry on the conversation. because it's because it's a long finish. It will be there for some time. No, it's gone.
Cheers. So, cheers. Anyway, which of the wines did you like best, Alan? I'm curious to know.
Which is the most... What are the prices individually? Bottle to bottle.
Right, well, this one here, this is £6. Uh-huh. Well, this is £8.95. And this one's quite pricey. It comes in at £12.
That one is the one I think had the best flavour. Can I have it?
Oh, yes, of course. Thanks. Absolutely.
I mean, I'll pay you for it.
Oh, no.
No, seriously. I'll see you. No. You're not leaving this studio, so there's a favour. You're not leaving this studio until you've got the full cost of that wine. That's more than the right amount. That's definitely, you can keep the rest, I don't mind. This is the Commodores with Three Times a Lady. That was very good. Thank
good.
You. That was just good radio.
Good.
Yeah, simple as that. Middle of the day, you bet. Middle-aged, maybe. Middle of the road, no way. Let's wrap this up. I think it's run its course. We'll look at the results for Norfolk's greatest person. My hat's in the ring. Actually, I'm going to take my hat out. There it is. It's a tie, a dead tie, between Oliver Cromwell and Horatio Nelson, exactly as I predicted. Why do I bother? That's rhetorical, by the way. Please don't text in. I know why I bother. I'm not prepared to go into that now, because right now it's time for Surname Mastermind. Hello, Chris, on line one. Are you there?
I'm there, yes. I'm here.
Chris, are you ready to play Surname Mastermind?
Yeah.
OK, here we go. Cheryl, Ashley.
Cole.
Correct. Simon, Yasmin.
Le Bon.
Correct. Michael, Shakira.
Kane.
Correct. Rod, Alana.
Cole.
No, Stuart. Dave and Samantha.
Cameron.
Yeah, that's right. You're listening to AP with MMM on NND. That's Alan Partridge, Mid-Morning Matters on North Norfolk Digital. Please keep the messages coming in for King and Carr. Especially want to hear from you if you're on Twitter. Please message me at Alan Gordon Partridge.
Alan, just thinking, Twitter is the ideal medium for you, isn't it?
How so?
Well, your name's Partridge, and a partridge is a bird, and birds Twitter.
You are no way. You're bang wrong. Not a partridge. A partridge emits a combination of a trill and a pained cry. It's sort of a... I think I used to be able to do this. All right, I could do this the other day. It's got a sort of sad quality. There's a certain sort of...
haunting.
Yeah. But higher and quicker.
Mm. Yep. Why are you called at Alan Gordon Partridge? Why not just simply at Alan Partridge?
That name, Alan Partridge, that name was taken.
Oh, was it? That's annoying, isn't it?
Yeah, not really.
It's probably set up by one of your fops.
What's a fop?
A fan of Partridge.
Oh, that's quite good. I might use that. Yeah. Fop.
Well, for heaven's sake, don't use Alan's internet disciples.
AIDS. Yeah, that would be embarrassing, wouldn't it? If the parent company here found out you had AIDS, you'd be out on your ear, and rightly so.
So your middle name is Gordon. That's hilarious.
Do you mind? Gordon's actually a rather good middle name. AGP. AGP. Sounds like a motor oil.
Very
imagine
manly.
On the side of a Formula One car.
Very manly.
It is manly, yes. It's actually terrible for Sue Cook. Her middle name's Ingrid.
Sick.
Yeah.
Well, at least the middle name isn't Ursula.
Suck. Yeah, that would be
worse.
Yes, it could be worse. It'll always be worse. Or Amanda.
Sack.
Yes. Precisely.
Well, what's rude about a sack?
Well, it's a nickname, isn't it, for ball bag? This is Enya with her Orinoco Flow. Good.
Yeah, very good. Yeah.
Today's question. Which is, how often should you wash your towels? Sally from Norwich writes, I put my towels on a boil wash once every 10 days with a flap of Bounce. Sally, I do exactly the same thing, and if I'm going to chuck in a bit of underwear, I might add a capful of Dettol, maybe two, depending on, you know, circumstances. Retired head teacher Teresa Staples says, I've cut the frequency of my towel washing by using a simple technique. After my bath, I take an old beach towel and drape it over my favourite armchair. Then I sit back with a box of wine and watch Cash in the Attic till I'm bone dry, by which time I'm normally sound asleep. It sounds like bliss, Teresa. Really does. Now, if I were to say to you,
I like your nuda,
you'd say, I'm sorry, Alan. And if I said, I was simply saying, I like your noodles, you'd say, oh, now I understand. But I think you were being a little bit racist. You'd be absolutely right, but you'd be ignoring the fact that I just paid a very good compliment to Asian cuisine. Each day this week, I'm going to be trying a different kind of ethnic cuisine to help promote tolerance and harmony amongst the various creeds and colours that have drifted into Norfolk over recent years. Today's the turn of the Japanese. Years ago, my granddad John used to sit me on his knee and he'd say, Alan, I hate the Japanese and I hate Japanese food. But if granddad John was alive today and I was able to feed him some of the sushi rolls lovingly prepared by my good friend Ando at Miso Tasty, I think all the anger that he harboured at having been tortured within an inch of his life at a Japanese prisoner of war camp would instantly fade away, especially if he tried it with Ando's delightful wasabi sauce. So that's on its way shortly. The time is 59 minutes to one. It's just gone midday.
The weather, sponsored by Turner's Kitchen Solutions.
You're listening to Alan Partridge. A quick look at the results of our online poll. In fourth, it's Maris. In third, is Pied of Hamelin. Second, it's Billy. But your favourite piper, it seems, is Bag. I'm surprised. I thought it would be a slam dunk for Billy in the piper poll. Let's have a look at this article in this morning's paper. It's from Dr. Marion Pruton. Now, she urges men to talk more about bowel cancer. Bowels shouldn't be taboo, she says. Men shouldn't be embarrassed to discuss the dangers. I quite agree. I'm very open about it. I'm very candid, very happy to say that I try to maintain a healthy anus. And, you know, I'm largely successful. There's the odd mishap, but law of averages, you're not going to get it right every time. Now it's time to step back into the past and ask, if historical monarchs could drive a modern car, which one would they choose? Gerald in Bury St Edmunds, hello.
Hello, Alan.
What have you got for us?
Alfred the Great and a Mitsubishi Shogun.
Bullseye. Mary on line two, what's your king and car?
Well, he's not strictly a king, but I was thinking Oliver Cromwell would drive a Lexus.
No.
Oh, well, maybe a VW Phaeton, then.
Oliver Cromwell?
Yeah.
I'm not sure you got the hang of this, Mary.
Oh, sorry, Alan.
That's all right. Why don't you hang up? Have a little think and call back later.
Yes. It would mean I'll have to pay for another call.
That's fine. I've got to say, it makes me laugh when I hear people say VW. It's actually quicker to say Volkswagen. I mean, if I had a pound for every time I heard someone use an acronym that actually extended the syllable count, I'd be a millionaire. We've got John on line two. Hello, John.
Hello, Alan.
Where are you calling from?
Home.
Okay, and what have you got for us?
Well, I'd like to stick with Cromwell, please. I think he would drive a Golf 1.6 turbo diesel.
Better, much better.
Being a Puritan, he'd appreciate the economy, but also the build quality, and would go for the standard interior because he wasn't at all flashy.
I'm liking this, John. I'm liking this a lot. I think this is the best call I've ever had.
Thank you very much.
Let's keep going. Optional extras.
Cromwell was certainly no fool. He'd have parking sensors front and rear.
Of course he would. You should call more often. Where are you based?
I live in Surlingham.
Do you ever go in the Woods End pub?
Yeah.
So do I. There's a great folk group there, sing on a Sunday night.
Right. I hate folk music.
I'd agree with you, but these are very funny. They're called Will o' the Wisp.
Oh, yeah.
And they have humorous lyrics. They sing about the regulars. We should go for a drink there sometime.
Yeah, maybe.
Sundays are always good for me. John?
Yeah.
By the way, what did you have for Henry VIII?
Oh, Range Rover Vogue 4.6 petrol, sage green with a saddle tan interior.
Yes. of course you would. And in the cool box in the centre of the compartment, he'd have his chicken drumsticks.
A six-pack of mead.
Yeah, six-pack of mead. Some mints in the glove box, you know, his gauntlets, and he's going to need all that room for Anne Boleyn, Cardinal Wolsey, and probably a court jester.
I don't think he'd have Anne Boleyn and Cardinal Wolsey in there, to be honest. They despised each other. Likely he'd have... Yes, he'd have Cromwell in the back, whispering in his ear, probably.
Oliver Cromwell? He wasn't born for another 50 years. Egypt.
I think he meant Thomas Cromwell.
There's more than one Cromwell, Alan.
I know there's more than one. Dozens of Cromwells. Look at the phone book. I've got a friend called Cromwell. Actually, he's called Cresswell. Let's call him back. Thanks, John.
Can I just say hello to...
Yeah, that was good. That was it's good. It's good. I like it when you chip in.
Oh, cheers.
Probably best when next time you do, just jot it down on a piece of paper, and just slide it under my nose, and
brilliant.
I can decide whether to give it the green light. For you to say, I might say it myself.
Okay.
And yeah, because that Cromwell bit didn't really work then.
No. Sorry, Alan.
Just looking at some texts. Check out our staggering deals starting at 27999, and it's not just a great range of bed frames we've slashed the prices on. Yeah, you should probably go on holiday with that guy and just talk about different historical novels or something like that. Absolutely. You just joined us. I'm here with Sidekick Simon, having a bit of banter. There we go.
Sidekick Simon, Sidekick Simon. Sidekick Simon, Sidekick Simon.
Yesterday's quickfire phone-in only yielded three calls. My mistake. I think panel beating was too narrow a topic. So today we're going to open it out with the question, what is the best thing? What's the best thing of all? We've got Sky Plus, a cup of Brazil nuts, that was amusing, livestock, valid, and wet wipes. That was a fascinating call from an elderly lady in Hempton. Let's have some more. Line two.
The first smile of a newborn.
Ah, who could not like that? Who could not like that, though?
Herod.
Yes, Herod. That's right, because he was a baby killer.
He enjoyed... Yes, he killed lots of babies.
He did. We don't like him. Line six, Stuart.
It's sliced bread.
What about sliced bread?
Sliced bread, it's the best thing, isn't it? That's what people say. They say, it's the best thing, sliced bread is.
Well, that's a phrase, but it's not actually the best thing, is it?
Can I have a T-shirt?
No, of course you can't. That's just a turn of phrase.
Yeah, but it's the best thing, isn't it? Because it's what people say.
I know they say that. I'm familiar with the phrase, but it's just a turn. It's not literally true.
Then why do people say it? Of course,
because
it's true.
It's not.
Sliced bread is the best thing. It's the best thing.
If you keep saying it, sure, it's not going to make it any more true.
We all know the phrase, mate.
We all know the phrase. It's just an idiom.
You're an idiot.
No, an idiom, not an idiot.
You're
an idiot for not knowing what idiom is. It's clearly confused you because you think I've just substituted the T with an M, you stupid gim. you momal mwam. You're a complete cunm.
Well, I think you're a prick.
Right, get rid of him. Sorry about that. I should have knocked him off more quickly. I wasn't quick enough. I apologize.
And a dick.
Shit. Right. Right. Well, he's gone now, but I'll continue to speak my mind about him. Stuart, I've got to say, I think the Clifton Suspension Bridge was built for people like you. The fact that you can drive cars across it is a bonus. So do the decent thing, and leave the keys in your car so someone can shift it afterwards. And please don't call in saying I'm encouraging people to kill themselves
again.
Yeah, I'm suggesting that one person throw himself off Clifton Suspension Bridge because he is, and hopefully soon to be was, a very unpleasant individual. A bit like Jamiroquai.
Norfolk Digital.
It's North, it's Norfolk, it's digital, it's North Norfolk Digital. It's time for Sad Story. This is where I read a moving real-life story submitted by one of our listeners. Today's is from Lee Tibbs in Attleborough. My story begins late last spring. It was a fine morning, so I decided to go out for a jog in my shorts. I headed to the local park, and it was there, to my surprise, that I bumped into my old history teacher walking his dog. He remarked on how well I looked, and I returned the compliment. No, I'm not reading this. No. Absolutely not. Yeah, that's why he's wearing shorts. I should have seen that. It's all right, we have others. Today's sad story is from Deirdre Thomas from Dibbs Lane in Holt. Dear Alan, I want to be as honest as I can with you, so I hope you'll understand that I'd rather remain anonymous. Absolutely. My story begins in the mid-80s when I met Gareth. The truth is, he kind of swept me off my feet. He was tall, dashing, and had kind eyes like a cow. Really? Yeah, I suppose they do. Oh. Gareth knew I'd just come out of a serious relationship and wasn't ready to commit, but he called me the day before he went on a group camping trip and said someone had dropped out and would I like to join them. I'm just going to jump off the sad story because my sushi has arrived being brandished by someone I can only describe as some sort of food stig. In the meantime, here's the vapors with I'm Turning Japanese. What's today's paper, then?
So, let's see, you ordered California rolls, katsu curry, and I listen to Orbital Digital.
I listen to Orbital Digital.
What was that?
I listen to Orbital Digital.
Nice of you to recommend us. Christ. Alan Partridge, you have been punked by Orbital Digital. It's Craig Kilty, a.k.a. The Monster.
Fuck off. You're not even on air, you dick.
Oh, yes, we are. Double punk. You have been owned.
All right. Fair cop. Fair cop.
You have been owned.
Yeah, stop saying you've been owned by you. I'm owned by anyone. I'm owned by North Norfolk Digital. I'm certainly not owned by Orbital Digital. I wouldn't work for them if you paid me.
You've been owned.
Yeah, well, you know, at least I haven't got a brother in prison.
What's that got to do with anything?
Just having a joke, you know. It's not nice when the boot's on the other foot, is it? Hmm? It makes walking difficult, you know. The arch is on the wrong side. Doesn't work.
You don't know anything about my brother. Fell in with the wrong crowd.
Well, he's in with the wrong crowd now, isn't he? Literally, he's in prison.
Owning me, owning you.
That doesn't even make sense.
Aha!
Yeah, I do own that. I do, actually. I flew to Gothenburg to negotiate directly with Bjorni and Ben's lawyers for exclusive rights to shout but not say the word aha 50 times a year in perpetuity for the rest of my life or till 2015, whichever comes sooner. Sorry about all that Orbital Digital, OD. Wish they'd OD on heroin. It's Susan Boyle, Amazing Grace. This is Alan Partridge on North Norfolk Digital. I'm here with Sidekick Simon, who's about to give us a sideways look at the week's news.
I am.
Simon.
Okay.
What have you got for us?
What I have is a story about a story about a postman.
You should turn the corners down on the...
I did, well, I found it and turned the corner down, and then what's happened is it must have come back up. Sorry.
You're listening to Sidekick Simon.
Sidekick Simon, Sidekick Simon. Sidekick Simon, Sidekick Simon.
Yeah, I'm going to find it.
You've got to find it quickly.
It's on the left.
You've got to find it quickly.
It's on the left. Okay, this is not the one, but a beach litter pick is being held at Cromer. No. Got it. Okay, so a...
Oh,
sorry,
we're in business.
There we go. So a... A postman was expected to return to his family home on Friday evening at Ale Merton, but did not arrive and was reported missing that night. Now, my thing is that maybe he will arrive, but at the wrong address, in about three weeks down the line, they'll arrive back, but at the wrong address.
Yeah. But his body was found in a canal this morning, that's the thing.
So it sort of works.
Well, it's the wrong address, isn't it?
Yes, massively. It's in the canal.
OK, right, just time for news.
The headlines on the hour. The body of a postman reported missing on Friday.
Now it's time to return to Alan's sad stories. So things were going well between Gareth and I, but that was when our relationship took a twist that neither of us could have predicted.
Shit! Shit!
Shit, she writes, because... Gareth... died. But I married his twin brother, because he had a twin brother, who was identical. He had eyes like a cow too. So everything was back to normal again. until one day I discovered Gareth's brother in a compromising position with a box of Quality Street. He'd eaten three or four in sudden succession and completely ruined his appetite for the chicken dinner I'd so lovingly prepared. I was totally crushed. It was then I realised that Gareth's brother had a chock problem. Nothing would get in the way of his addiction. The lowest point came when I found him collapsed in a sugar-induced coma in the bogs of Yates's Wine Lodge in Yarmouth. We cried and cried that night. I reiterated my love for him, he reciprocated his love for me, and we shared a chocolatey kiss that will stay with me forever. But it was then that everything changed. Again. Because his weight had ballooned to 20 stone or thereabouts. When he came towards me to hug me, he fell on me and shattered my spine in three places. The police didn't believe him. And he was carted off to prison for GBH, or attempted murder, I forget which. I still visit him once a week in prison, and he tells me, Alan, that he tunes into your show, and it offers him great solace, great comfort. Not that the show is aimed at the criminal fraternity in any way. The cons tend to listen to Orbital Digital, as many of them have learning difficulties. I should add, the reason I was able to visit him was because of a pioneering operation which enabled me to walk again, because they replaced my spine with a new one made of carbon fibre, which is actually the material they use in the engine blocks and chassis for Formula One cars. It's actually lighter than aluminium. Yours sincerely, Deirdre. P.S. Unfortunately, I can't remember what our favourite song was. Ah, what a sad story. OK, please do keep your calls, texts and faxes coming in on today's big question, which is, how often should you wash your towels? Ted in Wisbeck has been in touch. I don't use towels. I use a hairdryer set on cool. It takes a bit longer, but it feels lovely, and I finish off with a little talc for my testes and bum. Mmm, lovely stuff. You're listening to Mid-Morning Matters with Alan Partridge. Now it's time for Alan Describes Art, in which I attempt to describe a piece of art created and submitted by one of our listeners. Today's comes from Mick Lindop of Heatherset. So here goes. Well, it's a charcoal drawing of a nude lady. She is splayed, let us say. I can't go into any more detail than that. And she has a C, D cup bust, pleasantly curvy elsewhere. All in all, a good body. And Mick entitles this Family, which is a bit odd. Perhaps it's his old mum. Got a coffee, please. Two sugars. Do make sure you stir it this time, because last time I ended up with a rather bitter drink followed by several teaspoonfuls of coffee-infused sugar sludge.
Oh, sorry about that.
I'm not having a go at you. I like you. And the coffee sludge was rather, in and of itself, quite tasty. You could serve it to one of your suitors. Are you being suited at the moment? Suited and booted? That sounds like you've been taken for a meal and then afterwards kicked, which does happen. I mean, that's the terrible thing.
I'll just give it a good stir then.
Yeah, precisely. Yeah.
It's not South. It's not Suffolk. It's not analogue. Sorry, must be North Norfolk Digital.
Love that jingle. Welcome back. Time again for our daily instalment of Radio Battleships, a game of tactic and nerve against Russian station Moda FM. We're joined, as always, by Andre.
Good day to you, comrade.
Hello, mate. You ready?
Ready.
B4.
Miss.
Okay. Join us the same time tomorrow for Andre's Move. You're listening to Mid-Morning Matters. Coming up soon, Tuesday Chat, our weekly hard-hitting celebrity interview. But first, let's go back to what is Alan firing his friend's air rifle into?
What is Alan firing his friend's air rifle into?
Quick reminder of the sound. And again. OK, straight to the phones. Steve from Lexham.
A bag of cement?
No, sir. Helen from Fransham.
A pig carcass.
It's not, but that would be interesting. Put it on the list. Debbie and Ronton.
A church.
I would never discharge a firearm in a house of God. Ross in Beckles.
I don't know.
Lindsay and Kings Lynn.
The sky.
Why would I fire into the sky?
As a warning.
I mean, you can quite clearly hear the sound of impact. If you are going to phone in, make sure you are at least on nodding terms with modern ballistics. Big yawn there from Psychic Simon. Well. You up late?
Oh, well, a little bit. I was just with Carl Branning, just doing a few bits and bobs for him.
What, DIY?
No, I was on his show.
What, you did bedtime with Branning?
Yeah, just a few little stupid sketchy bits, but you don't mind, do you?
Well, do I mind if a lab technician I met in a pub who's doing a trial period on my show appears on another show? No.
I'm going to grab a coffee.
Today's phone-in subject is how many disabled parking bays are too many disabled parking bays? Please keep your texts coming in on that. Who grabs a coffee? Unbelievable. He thinks he's a doctor on ER. I'll tell you how I met this chap. I had a god-awful day last Tuesday. I was having lunch with an entrepreneur from Nottingham. Let's call him Brian, not his real name. His real name's Keith. I suggested that we partake of some flagons of foaming ale and quaff medley, whereupon we alighted at the... I'm going to stop being a presenter from the past now. We went in and we decided to quaff. I'm doing it again. We went in a pub and had a pint of bitter. We had two pints of bitter. But when I went in there, this guy here was had me on the floor. Shoot me a pearl. Okay. Shoot me one of your pearls.
Naked chess match.
What?
Shall I do the one about the naked chess match?
No, don't do that. What was the thing when your friend phoned up? Hit it.
Yes, take it away. So Darren, Darren's wife had given birth to a baby, and I put the phone down and I said to you, she's just given birth, and she's given birth to some pastry, I think I said, and some cheese and some eggs. And I said to you, guess what she's called? You didn't know. I said, Lorraine.
Because it was a quiche.
Because that's the... a quiche, yeah. The name is Lorraine.
Quiche Lorraine. So that was the joke. And I said, imagine the midwife taking all this pastry and hot ham and cheese and pastry out from the crevice of a woman.
Said, yeah.
Do you write sketches?
No.
Okay. Let's have a bit of Duran Duran after that, listen to the dulcet tones of Simon Le Bon, which is actually French for Simon the Good. So you're very well prepared with all your papers and notes, Simon. Now it's time for Who Does Alan Think Alan Is?
Who do
you are.
Just to explain, the sense of that line was not properly explained to the voiceover artist before she went into the booth. By the time I find out, she was already in a cab. Complete waste of 30 quid. She sounds like she's been touched on a bus. My main guest today is one of the genealogists from BBC One's Who Do You Think You Are? Please welcome Henry Spring.
Hello. Our journey begins with your great-grandmother, Annie Partridge. Do you remember her?
I do, Granny Annie. She died when I was a toddler. She used to make me chucky egg. Egg and butter chopped up in a bowl. You add that to your files. Send it to the boys at WDYTYAHQ. Who do you think you are, headquarters?
Oh. Well, like many women of her time, she was a stay-at-home mum, wasn't she?
She was unemployed, yes.
But what you might not know is that if we delve one generation further back, we find she had an aunt who lived quite near here, so that would have been your great-great-aunt.
It's fascinating. Please tell me more.
She lived in a semi-detached house in Sheringham at the very end of the 19th century.
That must have been one of the first semi-detached houses in Norfolk.
Not in Norfolk, but it may have been one of the first in Sheringham.
But that's still fascinating. It sends a shiver down your spine.
Do you want me to get you up?
Rest in peace. Great, great, great aunt. What's her name?
We don't know. We just have the initial E.
Rest in peace. Mrs. E. Was she married?
We don't know that either.
Well, rest in peace. E. Partridge. What was the joke you were going to do?
I was just going to say, shall I go and get you a hot water bottle when you said you had a chill in your spine?
Yeah, that's good, yeah. I think I was right to stop you there.
Oh, yeah.
Henry, I'm right, am I not, that my distant relative was involved in perhaps one of the most important pieces of town planning that Norwich has ever seen?
Well, he worked in the Office of Town Planner.
Changing what was Deering Square into what is now Deering Lane.
They effectively made it a thoroughfare, yes.
It's amazing. I mean, the number of times I've parked on that road, never knew. I mean, I know it's loading only, but you park there after six, they never get you. I almost feel like crying.
Certainly made getting into the centre of town that bit more straightforward.
And the rest. If it weren't for Deering Lane, you'd have to come in on the Ring Road. I mean, it's just amazing that an ancestor man had to wrestle with that awful decision. I mean, on the one hand, you know, the square gave people somewhere to sit, a respite from the frenetic pace of life in Norwich. And yet on the other, I mean, direct access to Hobbs Road must have been like the promised land to civil engineers, cutting journey times from the east half of the city in half. It was caught between a rock and a hard place. It must have been bloody hard. I sent a shiver down my spine. Another one. That's the second one in half an hour. I almost feel like I should get a hot water bottle to reheat my spine. Now, a little genealogical bird tells me that there's a bit of a dark horse in the Partridge clan, a bit of a loose cannon.
Yes. His name is Edmund...
Black sheep, that's the third one.
Edmund Partridge. He was around until the late 1880s, had a spell in prison.
Did he now?
For debt. And then he moved to France, Paris, which where he died.
Yeah, he sounds like a right rummen. And what sort of roguery befell him? Was it, a brawl in a brasserie? How did he meet his maker? What was the cause of death?
Well, the coroner's report says the cause of death was syphilis.
Right. You can make eye contact with me when you say that, you know. I haven't got syphilis.
Sorry.
You're looking away like that, like it's, you know. This has nothing to do with it. You should be careful bandying around causes of death willy-nilly.
Well, the coroner's report does state it, so we can be pretty sure.
If I was going on a man's radio show to accuse one of his ancestors of a sex disease, I'd want to be more than pretty sure.
OK, then we're uber sure.
Why are you doing this? I have sponsors who will walk away like that if they get a sniff of VD.
Well, you asked me to look into it, so...
How would you like it if I said your great-grandmother soiled herself at George Formby's house and had a hump?
She wouldn't, and she didn't.
Well, you have a... use one of your sense of humours, your jokes on him.
Well, I can do. A minute ago, you're telling me to shut up.
Well, I've changed my mind!
Well, you come on here and you start dragging the Partridge name through the muck. Who do you think you are?
That is the best joke you've done all day. Absolute. Six of those a show and you're away. Keep your clubs away from his young. It's Seal.
North Norfolk Digital.
Time now to reveal Tuesday Chat's interviewee. It's a man who perhaps I know better than anyone else.
Are you interviewing yourself?
My guest is Alan Partridge in his first ever broadcast interview, much like Frost Nixon, but...
this time, Partridge.
Why do you keep finishing my sentences? You know, you might feel good about yourself because you've guessed something, but it doesn't do anything to
improve the show, yeah.
Exactly, you're doing it again. You know, you just...
I'm making it worse.
The interview is Partridge/Partridge. It's me talking to myself.
Sounds worrying.
Not like the man in the park who stands by the pond. Yeah, it's quite sad, actually. He used to run the cycle shop before it went bust. Now he seeks solace in cider and swans.
Better than seeking solace in cider swan.
Yeah, although I think even that's only a matter of time.
Yeah.
So that's Partridge on Partridge in half an hour. Now, though, a song from Michael Jackson in happier times before his mauling from Martin Bashir that led ultimately and directly to his death and to Diana's. La 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 la. So what's Carl Branning like then?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's all right. Nice. Yeah. He does a brilliant bit where
la 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 la. See, they've opened up the Norfolk Broads to wheelchair users.
Are they?
Unbelievable.
Good or bad?
You tell me. You tell me. No, tell me.
Good, is it? Bad.
Bad. Yeah, it's bad. It might seem like a good thing, but how many people do you know in wheelchairs who genuinely want to go on the Norfolk Broads? I'd suggest it's 0.0000001%. Is it worth the disruption for largely blameless able-bodied people? Just a...
Okay. Just what what would your opinion be if you were...
Two sides to every story.
What about if you had an accident and you were in a wheelchair?
I just watch TV.
Fair play.
Or go on the video. Or go on the computer. Loads of things you can do. Now it's time for the very special edition of Tuesday Chat. It's me, on Alan, on Alan, on I, on I, on Partridge, on Partridge. It's me.
On a loop?
No, I kept singing it over and over. You can tell because on the fifth one, I swallow my mistake.
Hello, Alan.
Hello, Alan.
We meet at last.
Indeed we do.
You're looking well?
Thank you. I'm not a member of a gym, although I do work out. I use two carrier bags filled with tins of value beans.
Impressive.
Thank you.
You've been a professional broadcaster for 28 years.
29, actually.
Yes, you're quite right. Sorry about that.
No matter.
And in that time, what would you say has been your greatest achievement?
I think my consistent resistance to dumbing down. I think, if anything, I've tried to dumb up.
But as an experienced interviewer, who has been your toughest interviewee?
I'd have to say Desmond Tutu. I had absolutely no idea what he was going on about.
And the friendliest?
That would have to be the athlete Colin Jackson.
Chris Akabusi.
Yes, Chris Akabusi. I mean, we still keep in touch once a week on the phone.
Sounds like fun.
It is.
Tell you what, why don't you take a breather? Let's pick this up a little later when I'll be grilling you on your family.
Looking forward to it.
Yeah, it certainly does. Back soon.
Okay.
It's me, on Alan, on Alan, on I, on Partridge, on Partridge. It's me.
I love that effort. What, give them away! Okay, time for some more calls on...
What is Alan firing his friend's air rifle into?
That sound again. And again. Line 10, what am I firing my friend's air rifle into?
A sandwich.
Wrong, line 3.
The future?
Are you on an E? Line 6.
Don't know.
Did you call earlier?
Yeah, I did.
Unbelievable. Line four.
Chop, chop, the nurse is here.
What the hell's all that about?
No idea, mate.
Seriously, what?
Might have something to do with me.
Why?
It's to do with something I did on the on Branning's show last night.
Well, let's hear it.
Move on.
No, let's hear
move
it.
Move on.
Let's hear it. Seriously.
It wouldn't work now.
You can't deprive the listeners of mid-morning matters.
On this occasion, I think I should.
Seriously, let's hear what you did.
Really? Yes?
Yeah.
On, okay, well, Carl Branning was under the weather, and he had some night nurse and some day nurse. And so the big joke was, you know, which one should he take? Because it's the night time, but he still didn't want to go to sleep. And then the callers started, it's like the late at night, the callers are a bit more sort of zany. So they start calling in and with the other suggestions for nurses and people. And anyway, the point was someone called in about a mental nurse. And then I basically was then a mental nurse for the next hour, just doing a, you know, stupid character about this nurse who kind of scuttles around the wards and is like putting milk into the drips and things, and she's just toppling people out of beds. And I don't really.
Psychic Simon. Oh, don't worry about it. Wait a minute. Have you seen Duck Soup and Mock Spiders?
Oh, yeah.
You'd love that. Okay, time for traffic and travel.
Traffic and travel.
Morning, Alan.
Oh,
gosh. You're all right.
It's okay. You're in progress.
Yes,
no, it's fine. Fine.
Okay.
Yep.
Want me to help you?
No, it's fine. Fine.
James,
it's fine.
You're
it's
okay.
Fine.
You're okay. Good.
Which,
nerves.
Yeah. No. Mop. Nervous.
Are these all yours?
Yeah, mugs. They're coffee mugs. I came in early, so to at 4 o'clock because I wanted to be.
Oh really?
Absolutely on the on the balls.
on the balls.
Are you nervous?
Okay. Oh God, no! I've been doing it too long.
Yeah. Yeah, you have, haven't you? I mean, where would you go? I mean, there's. The BBC won't let you pass the door if you're over 30.
No, that's true.
Unless you've got a mop and a bucket, you know, and you're from somewhere, you're not British.
Yeah.
I suppose there's always songs of praise, isn't there? Songs of praise for you guys.
No, well, no, because that's now presented by young gay men, isn't it? So.
Well, there you go. I mean, ironic, really. There was a day when they would have been chased out of church with a big stick.
Right, here we go.
And then burnt!
So a bit of banter.
Okay.
Just keep it light.
Okay.
Off we go.
Right.
Today with Eddie Shepherd and Terry Cohen.
This is North Norfolk Today.
In case you're wondering if Eddie Shepherd has had his adenoids removed or has finally cut down on the fags, neither is true. You're listening to Alan Partridge. Eddie's adenoids continue to block the vast majority of his nasal passages, and he continues to smoke like a gangster in a 1940s film, who even the other gangsters think, smokes to excess, and tell him so.
And Alan's in for Eddie all week. It's great to have you with us, Alan.
Pleasure to be here.
Very welcome.
Thank you. And thank you. I'm very happy to be on the show. I listen to it every morning.
Oh, do you?
In Cafe Nero, yes. By default. I mean, they pipe it in. So you provide the soundtrack while I chomp on my egg panini with extra egg.
Mm-hmm.
An extra egg.
Sounds delicious.
It is.
It's 7:01.
Very nearly.
And it's time for a review of today's papers with Alan.
Right you are. So I have got some big tits for you. Tit bits. Tit bits.
Freudian slip there. Oh dear, sorry about that.
I don't know what all the fuss is about, really. I mean, they're just pointed sacks of fat on the upper torso of a woman, for goodness sakes. What's the big deal, people? I mean, we've all got our favourite, gland. Mine happens to be the mammary. The Independent leads with government in secret spending cuts.
Well, that's yesterday's paper you got there, Alan.
Right, I've read all yesterday's papers. What am I going to do? And now traffic and travel.
we hadn't got that in yet. We haven't got traffic and travel.
That's fine. The roads today are fairly normal. I'm being told that there are potentially going to be some hold-ups. Nothing major, nothing that I can be specific about at this stage, but generally be vigilant, drive in a normal way, and stay tuned for more traffic updates. I hope that is helpful. The police also say to be careful if the roads are icy, but they're not suggesting they are at the moment, though they may be. Just keep your eye. Just drive sensibly, for Christ's sakes.
7:03.
Well, it is now, yeah. That was Alison Moyet again. And now for the final choice cut of Partridge on Partridge.
Sounds like two birds copulating.
Not now, mate.
What about family? Got any kids?
Yeah, I got a couple, male and female.
Names?
Denise is the female, and Fernando, he's the other one.
Love them?
Just a bit.
Do they listen to the show?
Yes, they do.
It's not what they told me.
You don't know.
What would be your ideal evening?
I'll tell you what it wouldn't be. Having a pint of bitter with a traitor. Oh,
come on, Alan, give me a break.
Who said I was talking about you? The world doesn't revolve around you.
No, I'm not saying that.
You're not the moon.
Yeah, I thought you said you weren't bothered.
What about your favourite TV show?
Deal or No Deal, I'm not bothered.
And why is that?
Edmonds. You know, you can do what you like for all I care. It's a free country, unless they change the law.
What about a favourite war?
100 years. I'll tell you something else.
Any reason?
Pioneering use of cannons. You can make love to the guy for all I care. You know, bum time with Branning. You know, that's been legal since 67.
What's your greatest strength?
You give a break to a lab assistant from Secondary Modern.
Your biggest weakness?
Repays you by taking 30 pieces of Branning silver.
He's not paying me, Alan.
It's a metaphor.
What makes you laugh?
To recap, key strength, courage, weakness, too kind, funny, YouTube, sneezing panda. Enjoyed chat.
I enjoyed chatting to you too. Thanks, Alan. And tell Chapman I'll pay for the dry cleaning, but he should count
that's something else. And the answer to what is Alan firing his friend's air rifle into is a beef tomato. And here is Mick Hucknall.
So how is Eddie? I'm so sorry to hear
about him. He's struggling, I'm afraid.
Bad news, shadow on the lung. Mm. We've met before.
Have we?
Yes, June, earlier this year, the Nissan Local Hero Awards.
Oh, yeah.
We're having a bit of a chinwag about Abu Hamza, you know, the boss-eyed Muslim cleric with a hook for a hand?
Yeah.
We're talking about what other implements he may attach or disattach to his wrist, depending on his moves, if he could take his hook off.
What about an egg whisk?
Precisely, that was the...
hairdryer.
Oh, that's a good one.
Or an ice scraper for the windscreen on a frosty morning. Genuinely useful. But no, he'd make a great pantomime baddie, I always think. You know, where's Abu Hamza, the boss-eyed Muslim cleric with a hook for a hand who incites racial hatred? He's behind you. I'd go and see it. As long as it had someone like Phil Mitchell in it, you know, as well. Mm. He'd sort him out. Mm. Headbutt him. Mm. Right.
Right.
North Norfolk Today with Eddie Shepherd and Terry Cohen. And Alan Partridge, just to reiterate, Eddie Shepherd isn't with us at the moment. Can we say what's wrong with him?
He's doing all right.
He's doing all right. Touch wood, it's just a smudge on the X-ray. And we're joined by Conservative Councillor Bronwyn Matthews. We were just having a chinwag about Abu Hamza, the boss-eyed Muslim cleric with a hook for a hand, suggesting what implements he may put on his wrist in place of his hook. Bronwyn suggested a hairdryer.
So, Councillor, you're a Conservative. What's your view on the coalition?
Well, as you know, of course, we have an outright majority here on the County Council. Mm-hmm. But as far as Westminster Coalition's concerned, I mean, we're, of course, very supportive of them.
Sorry, I have nothing to say.
I always think that coalitions can work extremely well as long as there's firm leadership.
Bonnie and Clyde, they were a coalition.
Well, there's good ones and bad ones.
Yes, indeed.
Rose West and her late husband, Frederick.
Well, fortunately, here at Norfolk County Council, we have a majority and so can work alone. Mm.
Harold Shipman. It's just coming up to 9:11. Ooh, don't tell Abu Hamza. He'll be cracking open the champagne. Oh, no, they don't drink, do they? Sorry, I've been up since 4, reading yesterday's papers.
With respect, Councillor, I think our listeners will be more concerned about cuts to public services.
Well, absolutely, Terry, and that's why we've set out proposals
to ensure... Terry, let me take it from here, throw me the ball. Councillor, you talk a good game. I caught it, by the way. But I have figures that show that you plan to cut public spending.
Are you talking about the raw figures or the figures adjusted for inflation?
Yes.
Well, the first or the second?
The first.
In that case, that's wrong, because if you look at the figures, the actual spend has remained the same as last year, see?
Yeah, I understand it. I'm just checking it.
Well, it's there.
Yeah, that's fine.
Another area where we've seen a great deal of public anger is in council housing. Mm. Now, what is the proposal here?
I meant the second one, where the figures are adjusted for inflation.
Well, Alan, we've made no secret of the fact that we're not going to keep pace with inflation. In fact, it's one of the few issues that we have cross-party agreement on, so...
Right.
We've made no secret of the fact that we're going to have to make...
Bus fares!
I'm sorry?
Bus fares. Have you not put up bus fares?
As we said in our manifesto, we won't be putting up bus fares in any...
Have you put up bus fares?
Not in real terms.
Have you put up bus fares?
In line with inflation, we have had to keep pace...
Yes or no? Have you put up bus fares?
In our manifesto...
Have you put... up bus fares.
Yes, but only
yes,
in as
but
much...
You, yes, but you, yes, but yes, yes, yes.
Yeah.
Thank you. If you want to see that interview back online and see me getting a politician to admit something slightly different from what they said earlier and then no, saying, look, you said something slightly different
not
from
actually.
What you said earlier.
No, completely
misquoted. So, 1-0.
It's 10 a.m.
It's just after 10 a.m. You have been listening to Alan Partridge with special guest Tori Bronwyn Matthews, who's...
Tory Councillor Bronwyn Matthews.
Yeah, her, and what's your name?
Terry Cohen.
Terry Cohen. Get well soon to Eddie Shadow.
Shepherd.
Who I'm sure will get well very soon. That's rhetoric, not a prognosis. Right now, you're listening to Mid-Morning Matters with Alan Partridge. See ya.
Take a cup of personality, pour in some chat, and drink up some good company. I.e. Mid-Morning Matters with Alan Partridge.
Good evening, morning, afternoon. Who cares? Who gives a flying monkey? Because today we're talking about things you don't see much of anymore. Already we have capes, tinned meat, Horlicks, sparrows, hula hoops, the crisps, not the toy, hula hoops, the toy, not the crisp, swimming pools with deep ends, and asbestos. We'll be asking, should we bring some and or all of them back? So do please text, Twitter, spam, fax, page, write, and or email.
Okay. Here he is.
Oh, hello. Hello. I'm planning a trip to Beckles.
Ah. Daniel. I'll do that.
Fuck it. Hey,
okay.
What an absolute privilege it is to have you. I think it's our first internet millionaire, whatever you are, in the studio. So absolutely delighted.
Well, no ditto. My pleasure. Thrilled, really. Really.
Can I also say, what a fantastic handshake. That is actually one of the best handshakes. Firm, soft, warm, dry. Just real class and panache.
You're too kind. Yours isn't too bad yourself.
Yeah. Well, I've got the warmth and the firmness and the softness. I'm just working on the dryness. So, is that right? Yeah.
Good.
Right. Okay.
Am I in your seat?
No,
sorry.
God, no, absolutely no, God, no, we don't care about the old, all that seat shit. I sit there, sometimes I'll sit over there, lean on there, you know, squat on the desk.
Good, well, if you're sure.
Yeah, no, I can't stand those people who are like, oh, don't sit in my seat. No.
Good.
No, that'd be fine.
This is good.
That's right, it's got a sweet reach like that there. That. Actually, do you mind? I think we're a bit too club-faced.
Yeah.
Biz-facially.
Okay.
Just...
Yeah.
No way. Welcome back to Mid-Morning Matters. How would you like to hear an interview with someone far wealthier than you, Billy No Cash? because joining me now is an internet entrepreneur who made his first million by the age of 19, sold his first business to Microsoft at the age of 22, is on the board of no less than 12 companies, and has most recently created a new business networking tool dubbed the Facebook of Corporate Finance. Sorry for the silly voice there. And today he's come to share the secrets of his success, Daniel Langford.
Wow, thank you, Alan. That's, what a thorough introduction.
You can pop that down there. You don't need to keep that near your gob. Bits, bytes, RAM, bugs, worms, cookies, reboot, download, clear cache, do not filter results, and clear history. We are all familiar with computer terminology.
Dongles?
Do you dongle, Daniel?
I dongle.
If his dressing gown falls open.
Dirty get.
I think it, most importantly, Alan, is that we don't get bogged down with terminology. Yeah. Yes? Technology has to work for people. Computers work for us. We don't work for them.
Yes.
Yet.
Yes. Ah, yeah. No,
touch
that's
wood. Touch wood.
No, yeah. If we don't, if we've got to keep an eye on them, though, those ruddy things, bloody computer, you bitch.
Oh, well.
Sorry. No, I mean, anyone's seen iRobot with, what's his name, the big-eared black chap?
It's Will Smith.
Will Smith.
Oh, I see. Or Asimov, who wrote the original
book. Who wrote the book, yes. Yeah. I prefer the film.
Really?
Not having read the book.
Ah.
I know you're a people person.
Mm-hmm.
I could tell that straight away. Do you know why?
Why?
I'll tell you why, Daniel. It's because you use people's Christian names. You came in and you used mine. You used Simon's. Yes. I never call him by his name.
I like to think that I see people for who they are. Okay, not necessarily what's printed on their business card.
Well, that's interesting you say that, because what I've got embossed on my business card is everything I do. I leave nothing to chance.
Mm-hmm.
Business consultant, internet, just internet.
Right. Well, it's...
After-dinner speaker, before-dinner speaker, and then some unusual descriptions.
You've got attitude challenger. And this one sounds a bit more violent. Convention breaker.
Well, I hope not. I organise conventions, Alan. It's one of the things I do. In fact, I've got one happening soon at Somerset House. I hope you're not going to come along and break that. You're going to come smash that down.
No. In fact, when I realised that was an ambiguous term, I was really, really really upset, genuinely upset, because I am the last person that would do anything to harm a business convention. You know, the idea that I might, I don't know, interfere with an audio-visual presentation, it makes me feel physically sick.
Alan, I think what you're trying to convey, Alan, is that you are someone who likes to think outside the box.
It's that simple.
Uh-huh.
That's what I should have written on the bloody card, out-of-the-box thinker, that's all.
I should add it on.
You can pop that down there.
Yep.
Daniel, to continue my out-of-the-box thinking, let's spin a record. This one's by Elton John, and it's called Daniel.
People call me a workaholic, Alan.
It's not true.
Dicks.
Well, entitled to their opinion, but no, it's not true. To
me, Alan, it's fun. I wake up every morning and I'm excited.
Oh.
I get that from time to time.
You dirty get. How can someone... like, let's say, I don't know, me, replicate your success?
Let me ask you this, Alan. What do you think to date has been my biggest investment?
Money.
No.
Property.
No.
Do you own a quarry?
No.
Gold!
People!
Oh, God! Give me another one.
Because, you see, people...
I thought it was a game.
People are what really...
I know, people make all the difference, yes, I understand that.
The fact is, Alan, I like to surround myself with talented people.
As do I.
Thank you.
Not you, I don't mean him. If anything, he's a disappointment. You should see him eat. He looks like he's had a stroke.
OK.
What about weekends? Tell us about these away days you do.
Yes. I organise these weekends where we get a group of people together and we do an activity. We have fun and we talk. We inspire each other. It can be anything. It can be grouse shooting. It could be sailing, archery. This weekend we're going rock climbing up at Fort William. There's going to be about 20 of us. If I come back with one good idea, Mission accomplished.
That's fantastic.
Last weekend, we actually we went around Brands Hatch.
Sort of Chinese, isn't it? Oh, Brands Hatch. Sorry, I was a bit racist. It's funny, isn't it? You do a Chinese voice, it annoys some people. You do a black man's voice, all hell breaks loose. Explain that. You can't. They're both racist. But I would love to come on one of your away days.
Yes. No, we normally have business leaders.
Well, I've run businesses. I'm in the top tax-paying bracket of all time.
Mm. Well, we often leave a space open, you know, for left-field thinkers. We've had an RAF pilot. We've had Shami Chakrabarty from Liberty.
Never heard of her.
We've had a Paralympian, which was special.
That's kind. Hmm. What about a radio DJ?
That's a very good idea. It's a very good idea.
Anytime.
Yes.
Anytime.
I should look into Nicky Campbell, shouldn't I? He's got a very broad demographic, able to do both the heavy hitting stuff and is able to do the quiz shows.
Yeah, or fails at both, you know, just depending on your point of view. But I would be delighted to step in to the gap of one week on your away day.
He's not serious.
No, I'm not serious. I'm frigging serious. I'm on the wetlands this weekend on a three-man hovercraft with the head of the Norfolk Range Rover franchise and two PE teachers.
Two?
At least.
Is that four people on a three-person hovercraft?
Read my business card.
After-dinner speaker.
Rule breaker. It's written on the back.
Alan? Hello, sorry. Bit of an odd one. Reception have just had a call from the... Alan?
Yeah?
Yeah. Reception have just had a call from the tax office.
The Inland Revenue?
Yeah, they say that they heard what you were saying about your income earlier, and it doesn't just quite tally with their records. Just wanted to give them a bell.
What, so I massage the figures? Big deal. Send me to jail.
Well, just don't shoot the messenger. Just letting you know.
Haven't they got better things to do than harass a digital DJ?
Well, who knows?
Oh, God, I'm really scared. I've emptied myself in my unders. Just to clear something up, earlier I suggested that I was in the top tax band. Slight mistake there. 5% of my earnings are in the top tax band. The remaining 95 are in the lower band. To cut to the story short, I basically earn about a quarter of what I said earlier. And now the news, Gifford. The news with Chris Gifford.
Thanks, Alan. And the main story.
You're laughing at. A team of road traders have been conning elderly and vulnerable homeowners. What's got? All right, so the tax office didn't phone in.
What?
All right, okay. Fair enough. Let's all have a laugh at the expense of Alan Partridge. Yeah, very good. Whose idea was it? Yours, I suppose. Yeah? Right, yeah, I'll tell you what I think. I think you're a fucking dick, mate. I'll tell you something else. Don't you ever, 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 ever. Do something like that again.
Calm down.
I will make sure you will never, 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 never work in Norfolk Radio.
North Norfolk
Radio. You are this to me. You are this to me. This. And I am that to you. Massive. You are nothing. And I am Alan Partridge. You're listening to Good Morning Matters with Alan Partridge.
And sidekick Simon. We're cool, are we? We're all right.
Yeah, sure. This is Clannad. Today we're talking forced celebrity breeding. If you could take two famous people and force them to mate, who would it be and why? Line two, we have Duncan in Beccles. Hello, Duncan.
Hello, Alan. I'd go for Stephen Hawking and Pamela Anderson. Then you create a beautiful genius.
Or a disabled lifeguard.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you something, Duncan, you wouldn't be able to sack them. Not these days.
I actually saw you in a petrol station, Alan, about a year ago.
Did you?
Yeah, you looked quite angry. But you had brand new jeans on. Bye.
Bye. That was When Smokey Sings from ABC. We know the rest. It's the alphabet. Webcam voyeurs. Hello. You may be aware that I'm sitting in the presence of Zoe Scott. Great to have you on the team, Zoe.
Lovely to be your new sidekick, Alan.
What? I'm not sure I could say sidekick. I'm probably more like co-DJ.
OK.
Actually, well, no, I'm the DJ. What should we call you?
A banter jockey.
Yeah. Right.
BJ. No, that sounds a bit rude.
You're a breath of fresh air. You really are. And the same time tomorrow, it's the semi-finals of our religious debating competition, Creed Crunch, which sees last year's winner, Islam, face Hinduism after the Hindus knocked out Christianity in the quarters. Should be a lot of fun. Please, please, can we not have crowds amassing outside the radio station burning not very well-made papier-mâché effigies of me? And Steve Doran, for some reason.
The weatherman.
Yeah. I think this didn't like the sound of his voice. OK, here's the weather with Steve Doran. Welcome, Polly.
Hi, Alan.
So, if you just try and enjoy it, and we try and keep the conversation quite informal.
Yeah, but not too informal. I mean, it's not Nigel Pinsent's In Depth, but neither is it Wally Banter's Junk Box.
OK. All right, fine.
And also, Polly, if there's any gaps in the conversation or in your responses, then Zoe or I will jump in.
Yeah, like Polly filler.
Very good. So you're quite clever.
I do okay.
Yeah, you do, don't you? Okay, let's do it. I'm joined by agony aunt Polly Maplin. Hello, Polly.
Hi, Alan.
Our first caller wishes to remain anonymous, which in my experience means it should be a cracker. Hello?
I've had a really tough year.
An annus horribilis. Some people think that's Latin for irritable bowel syndrome. It's actually Latin for just the Queen's sad year.
Sorry. Go on, my love.
Okay, I'm a bit frightened of my husband, and I know he's been abusive in previous relationships, and he's recently started to behave that way towards me. But it's difficult because I know he's been under stress at work.
Can I just interrupt you there? I'm sorry, I didn't catch her name.
She's anonymous. You can call her what you like. Sissy.
Listen to me, darling. It's never, ever acceptable for a man to be abusive. Ever.
Can I just clarify something? Sissy, your husband, did he hit you or was it just a shove?
Why the distinction? I don't follow.
Well, I'm on your side. I know it's absolutely no longer acceptable to give your spouse a fat lip or a thick ear, and hasn't been acceptable since 1978, even in Scotland. But a shove...
A shove is absolutely not acceptable.
OK. I don't mean into a thorn bush, you know, or a skip full of broken fluorescent tubing. I mean just, you know, in the corridor, onto the carpet.
No, abuse is abuse. I mean, it doesn't even have to be physical. It could just be something like shouting in the car or...
Well, hang on, I mean, are you saying that in the early 80s, when I was giving my wife driving lessons and I said, Jesus, there's a kid, you dozy cow! That you're saying that's abuse, whereas I simply think I was trying to save the life of a child. Next caller.
So, a quick email here from Samantha, who says that she has fat arms.
Oh, Samantha. I mean, a lot of people, so many of you, have a fixation with physical perfection these days. It's because we're bombarded with images of size zero models, an impossible ideal to attain.
It is, absolutely. Samantha, I'm sure your arms are absolutely fine. She's got an attachment here. So, oh, my God, they are vast. Wow.
Alan.
That's... I've got to send this to Jonathan Ross.
OK, and, we've got a letter here from Lucinda. Lucinda says, I'm 45, but I'm going out with a 23-year-old man. But although he's very affectionate, he cannot maintain an erection, and I'm worried it's my fault. What shall I do?
Well, it's actually very common in younger men, much more so than people realise.
Yeah, yeah.
And, of course, we're lucky now to have Viagra.
Yeah, but although do not exceed the stated dose...
So, you've suffered from that, have you, Alan?
No.
Well, a lot of men have. I mean, it's nothing to be ashamed of.
All right, once. But that was only because I'd already commenced foreplay when I remembered I hadn't renewed my tax disc. But once I put a quick call into the DVLA, lovemaking could begin in anger.
I think it's all about making sure the conditions are right.
There have been times when I've been more rubbery than turgid. I mean, you can't just summon up tumescence like room service.
Yeah, and, you know, I think it's partly down to the woman to sort of help set the mood a little,
absolutely,
help man relax.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
thank you. I mean, it's all about mood. Take the phone off the hook. Mm-hmm. Put on some easy listening, Carpenter's Enya, and, of course, make sure the heating's on.
OK. Got another email here from Paul in Swatham on forced celebrity breeding. This one is Kylie Minogue and David Dickinson to make an Oompa Loompa.
Absolutely. Minogue provides the size, Dickinson provides the requisite skin tone and expression.
OK, and now it's time for more forced celebrity breeding. I've got Ibrahim on line one.
I was hoping to speak to Polly, actually.
Now, Polly's nipped out, I'm afraid.
Oh, OK. It's just I've been going out with this girl for 8 months now, and she suddenly told me she doesn't love me anymore. Could do with speaking to Polly.
Yeah, Polly's nipped out, mate, I did say.
No, you don't understand. I really love this woman, and without her, my life is empty. I think the time has come for me to end it.
Don't get Polly. OK, hey, listen, so stay calm. Abraham. I know what you're going through.
Really? How can you?
I just do. That said, if I could just do the traffic updates, as we're contractually bound, and it is nearly quarter past.
Oh, forget about it. Don't worry. This isn't...
Well, OK, all right. I won't do it.
You don't understand, do you?
I do. I'll tell you something, OK? So I'll tell you something I've never told anyone before. In summer 1980, I was on a country road and I was distracted by the Moscow Olympic boycott when I slipped on some shit and crashed into a horse. I was driving a car at the time, I must add that.
A horse?
Yes, I'd shattered both its legs. Well, two of them, it had four. I didn't know what to do. In the end, after phoning the RSPCA and putting on a Scottish accent, I wandered home, you know, past the slow-moving eastbound traffic on the A47.
Sponsored by Castrol.
Are you doing the traffic report?
Yeah. I'm spinning plates here, mate, I'll be honest. Polly, thank goodness I've got a sad Arab on line three.
Hello, Ibrahim. Polly here, my love. How can I help you?
It's my girlfriend. She told me she doesn't love me anymore and I'm thinking of ending the relationship.
Well...
Wait, you're not going to kill yourself?
No, of course I'm not going to kill myself.
Mate, if I'd known that, I would have never have told you about my equicide. Thanks a lot, Abraham.
Ibrahim.
North Norfolk Digital.
I've got a letter here from Katie in King's Lynn. She says that her grandmother died over a year ago and she still cries every day.
Oh, well, Katie, you must remember, my darling, that there's nothing wrong with crying.
Nothing wrong with crying. Nothing wrong with crying. I sometimes cry in the shower. That way you don't know if it's hot water or tears.
It wouldn't be much good to her, though, if she takes baths.
No, you can cry underwater. As long as you can hold your breath. I find 30-second bursts are more than ample for the problems I encounter.
What sort of problems do you encounter?
I use short-burst underwater crying for lots of things. Like, say, when I think about the dog I had when I was 11.
What was he called?
Barney the dog. He could balance footballs on the end of his nose. Buried him in the back garden.
Were you alone?
People offered to help, but I wanted to do it by myself.
The alphabet from A to Z, it's Alan and Zoe.
But mainly Alan. You listen to Mid-Morning Matters with Alan Partridge and my little pocket ray of sunshine, Zoe Scott.
Speaking of sunshine, Alan, have you treated yourself to a sunbed last night?
No.
What about a spray tan?
don't think so.
Morning, everyone. You're listening to MMM with ZS and AP, or Zap.
You've got such a lovely, engaging way with people. You really have. OK,
so,
today's... We're like an old married couple.
Yeah, pretty soon we'll be bickering all the time. You know, you'll be drinking too much.
Hey, and then you'll get jealous of my career and run off with a fitness instructor. No thanks. Been there, done that, got the T-shirt. She got the T-shirt. Got the shirt off her back, really did. Fucking witch.
Well, I just found that when she strayed from historical fact, that took me out of the story. Apart from that, I thought it was a very good first effort.
Yeah, I've got to say, I'm a little surprised, Crispin. I found that Mantle's main characters are scorchingly well-rendered. And the sharp-clawed machinations are presented with non-stop verve in a book that can compress a wealth of incisiveness into a very few well-chosen words.
That's just word for word what it says on the back of
That's
the
book. That's my book of the week. That's Hilary Mantle's Wolf Hall. Oh, do you know what? If I'd known you were going to wear this kind of pink... I mean, I know enough about colour to know this pink clashes with that pink. Correct?
Not clash. It's not quite the same.
This is raspberry, definitely. Yeah. How would you describe that?
I would say that's like strawberries and cream.
It is like... It's like a strawberry milkshake.
Yes, it is.
I would drink you dry. I would...
Very good.
I'm down to your boots.
Oh, God. Okay.
Can I have another? Oh. I'm still thirsty.
Oh, Alan, you do really remind me of my dad. You know, you'd really like him.
Well, I love dads. I am a dad. I've got a dad. Well, I had a dad.
Oh, what was he like?
What was he like, my dad? I remember one birthday he bought me this big red cake in the shape of...
space rocket?
No.
Train?
No.
Football?
No, it was a rectangle. And I remember he came up and said, "Delivery for Mr. Partridge." Oh. I was so excited. Mm. I banged into the table and, oops, the cake went everywhere. Oh. My dad walked up to me. He said, "You will never amount to anything." He said, "You're that to me." Imagine saying that to a seven-year-old kid.
Alan, that's terrible.
That's not the end of the story, because as he turned round to storm off, he slipped on the cake, legs went flying, banged his head, and he needed 11 stitches. And I was glad. This is a little itty-bitty of scritty-pilitty. What you got on your iPod, Zoe?
I have got a bit of Mumford and Sons, a bit of Kings of Leon.
Do you like Kate Bush?
It's all right.
All right, you've got more talent than a little finger than I've got in my entire arms. It's the sheer versatility of her lyrics.
Yeah,
I'll give you an E.G.
Okay.
E.G. Oh, he's here again, the man with the child in his eyes.
Mm-hmm.
That could be... Oh, he's here again. The man with a child in his eyes. he's here again. The man with a child in his eyes. It's a little camp one.
Yeah, I like it.
He's here again. The man with a child in his eyes. He's here again. The man with a child in his eyes.
Okay. But how do you think she actually meant it?
Oh, he's here again. The man with the child in his eyes.
That one was about you, Alan.
This is Terry Jacks' Cousins in the Sun.
Do you remember, we got onto the subject of boots and you had never heard of Uggs.
I thought you were talking caveman language, ooga booga looga, or some sort of witch doctor voodoo, sort of, ooh, booga booga, me mend lady leg with blood from monkey and milk from another monkey. Time for traffic and travel.
Traffic and travel with Bulldog Conservatories.
Oh, God. Oh, I got this dinner I'm supposed to be having with this boring but very important friend of mine who's he's got the whole of the franchise for the Norfolk Range Rover dealership. And Cambridge for his sins. By the way, if you ever want to borrow a Range Rover, give me 6 months' notice and I can organise it like that.
Great.
No charge. I mean, just, yeah. Don't take it outside mainland UK or exceed 500 miles. Bring it back with a full tank. And obviously, you know, organise your own insurance. You're over 25, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's what I said. I said she's over 25. I said she looks younger. But she's over 25. So, yeah. Just, you know, apart from that, fill your Uggs. What did you want it for again?
I don't.
Oh, yeah, it was my idea, wasn't it?
Top up.
Yes. Fill your... Oh, I said that. Well, fill your mugs.
Very good.
Yeah, he's a big cheese poo, in a in a pond, in a small pond,
big fish.
A big fish, not cheese. What's wrong with you, you nutter?
Again.
Yeah, again, two suicides. Yeah, you really are like a breath of fresh air, Zoe. You're honest to God. I mean, you could come in here in the morning with a bulb of garlic stuffed in your mouth, two cloves in your ears, two stuffed up your nose, and. No, just that, and you'd still have a breath of fresh air.
Alan, if I wanted to ward off vampires, I'd just use my crucifix. Alan, I'd just drive a stake through your heart.
You already bloody have. It's goodbye from me.
And cheerio from me.
That's all from Zoe and Alan. On Mid-Morning Matters, when once again, mid-morning mattered. Lovely. Lovely. Weirdest thing, I just got a text from my Range Rover guy.
Mm-hmm.
His wife has broken her kneecap.
Oh, God.
I know. He just called me and all at sixes and sevens. I said, just forget about the dinner. I mean, high-powered, you know, mutually lucrative business meetings are one thing, but what's more important is looking after the people you love.
So what are you going to do instead?
I'll just go home and finish off reading The Lovely Bones. Yeah, it's a sad book, but it's sad in a sad way.
I need a box of tissues by the bed.
I already got a box of tissues by the bed.
Alan, do you ever just want to, you know, drop it all and just run off into the distance?
I do sometimes have a fantasy where I just... get on the next plane to the US and I retrain as an air marshal. Yeah. Sometimes I think I'd love to see out my days, you know, travelling back and forth on US domestic airlines whilst carrying a concealed firearm.
Wow. Yeah.
What about you?
Oh, totally. I mean, that's why I'm going travelling.
Mm. When?
Monday.
How long?
3 months, travelling Southeast Asia.
Really?
Mm. Oh, I'll write your postcard. You know, apparently the beaches are amazing. They've got these huts, and you can just dive straight into the sea from your hut.
Splashing and splushing and working up an appetite for a breakfast fit for the man from Del Monte. He's basically a quality controller for a tinned food conglomerate.
Yeah, and then seeing out the sunset with cocktails.
Then curl up in a double-sized hammock and give each other a cuddle.
Yeah, I'd probably actually go out clubbing, because apparently those midnight raves are amazing.
Actually, I've just realised I've still got the reservation.
My flatmate has got my sunglasses, Alan. I'm really sorry. Yeah. I've got a memory sieve.
Just realised, actually, I've still got a reservation at the restaurant. Maybe we just have a dine together?
Well, my friends have just texted and they've set me up on some ridiculous blind date with some doctor.
Oh, right. So... OK. Well, yes, like I say, leave you at a loose end. That's all.
O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be controlled as to control, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my heart. Make me a channel of your peace.
And so on and so forth. That was our hymn of the day. It's 10 a.m. and this is Mid-Morning Matters with me, I, Alan Partridge. And the words of Freddie Flintstone, today's show is going to be yabba-dabba-doo. Huh? Oh, sorry,
Sorry, I did Jimmy Savile there.
Sir.
Yes, no, of course, yeah, absolutely. Sir Jimmy Savile, the disgraced knight of the realm. And a quick correction. Yesterday, I read out a text saying that estrogen was a kind of gas used to blow up balloons. Of course, it isn't. It's a hormone used by women to perform a number of tasks relating to themselves.
And others.
Thank you. OK, time for today's large question.
Large question.
If you could invite anyone to a dinner party, who would it be, dead or alive?
Well, I'd probably go for alive. Well,
seriously, though, who would they be?
Well, I've got them here. I would have Cubby Broccoli, Jasper Carrot, Mary Berry, Jack Lemon and Mr Bean, just to make sure I definitely got my five a day.
Yeah, no, well, no, seriously, though, that would get things moving. Or is that all right now?
So who would you have at yours?
Jesus Christ, Margaret Thatcher, Dennis Thatcher, Carol Thatcher, and Mark Thatcher.
So just it would be Jesus and the Thatcher family.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have a tweet from Janie72, who tweets to say she'd invite the Harlem. You alright?
Yep.
Yep. She'd invite the Harlem Globetrotters and Nigel Farage.
Oh, he'd get battered. We're talking dream dinner party guests. Line four, Nathaniel.
I'd have a banquet at Hampton Court Palace with Alexander the Great, Ronald Reagan, Winston Churchill, Noel Edmonds, Mozart, the Crankies,
a lot of people,
Attila the Hun, and James Dean. Then I'd blow up the building and wipe them out.
Why would you want to kill people when most of them are already dead?
Well, Noel Edmonds isn't. He's still very much at large.
Right, so the other guests are merely bait for Edmonds?
Precisely, yeah.
But you'd be destroying a national monument.
Well, I've thought of other venues, but I need to be absolutely sure that Edmonds will attend. And my research tells me that if it's hosted at Hampton Court Palace, then he'll definitely come.
So why are the Crankies there?
I plan to strap the explosives to Jeanette Cranky, as he'd be unlikely to search her.
Right, yeah, no, in the current climate.
Well, it's Operation Yew Tree.
Yeah.
He'd be assaulting both a woman and a minor.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah, excellent. I like it. It's a clean kill. Do call again, Nathaniel. Line three, Jez, who's coming to dinner?
Oh, that, I don't give a toss about dinner.
Is it already easy?
That guy kills foxes, and you didn't challenge him on a single thing he said. He was totally one-sided. If you want me to Photoshop your face onto the picture of a fat woman's body and tell people that's what you look like under your clothes, you're going about in the right way, sunshine.
Well, obviously, I don't want that, so... Are you quiet because you're angry, or is he quiet because he's angry?
He's gone.
Fine.
Colby, I'm your stepfather, and that accords me certain rights. Yes, she's your mother, but she's also my bird. I just don't see why I should take the blame because your dad ran off. He did. He did. He did. Colby. He's not on an oil rig. He's in the Cotswolds.
I mean, even the noise he made sounded like a siren. How's about that? Almost.
Maybe it was there was a part of his brain that was actually trying to warn people.
It could well be. We don't know how half the brain works. Just, God. Ugh. Coming up, a chance to win a free CD from Jazzy Jeff and the French Prince.
French Prince, is it?
It's the
Fresh, maybe?
Fresh Prince.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, well, of course, well, they're all Republicans, aren't they? And if you're a Frenchman claiming to be a prince, you'd be certainly very soon end up being beheaded by a revolting peasant. Joining me today, someone else who presumably finds peasants revolting.
I'm not sure about that.
Well, fear about. Because this weekend sees the annual North Norfolk Hunt.
Whoa. Careful how you say that one.
Why? It's traditionally a time of intense shouting from both sides of the hunting debate, be it the grunted chant of the balaclava or the reasoned oratory of the North Norfolk huntsmen and women. I see the point you're making. Yep, on the...
Careful.
On the advice of police, we've agreed to give the leader of the Norfolk
Hunt, a platform to appeal for calm, especially after the ugly scenes last year when I think a Lord got thumped. Please welcome Sir Cecil Phillips. That wasn't you, was it?
No, I'm not a Lord.
Oh,
thank you. Many thanks for having me here.
An honour and a privilege. Now, your message to the protesters is quite simple.
It is, yes. It's
look, you've had your say, but this is private property, so on your way.
Well, no. No. Whilst we don't share the views of the anti-Hunt lobby, we do respect their right to disagree with what we're saying.
The right to be heard, sure. But, if they cross the line, there are 1,000 Countryside Alliance boys ready to go.
Well, the Countryside Alliance is really a lobbying organisation.
And how? It's what the National Trust would be if it grew up there.
No, the point I'd really like to get across is that if you try to sabotage the safe passage of the Hunt, you're endangering yourselves. You're endangering us, and you're endangering horses.
Horses. Clever. Horses are animals.
Yeah.
Snookered.
Well, maybe they should play snooker. No one gets hurt in snooker.
What? Have you seen Minder? Minder was a television programme many years ago when a rather vulgar chap from ITV would gallivant around London, you know, resolving petty monetary differences with people, often at the fat end of a snooker queue. They're not allowed to show it anymore. Another ITV, by the way, is the channel that used to show the commercial. You don't need to know about that.
Traffic and travel, sponsored by Castrol.
TNT on the A17, a truck has overturned, shedding its load of Pampers over both carriageways. Sounds like the setup to a joke, doesn't it?
The police don't yet know which skid marks
are... Just stop you there. There has been a fatality.
North Norfolk Digital.
Later on, we'll be talking about corner shop fizzy drinks and asking what part of multi-pack not to be sold separately don't they understand? And talking of fizz, I've got to give a big shout-out to our new MD, Craig Felbridge, who this morning was absolutely fizzing with ideas. He was like a one-man soda stream. I felt so...
carbonated.
Oh, exactly. My head was going, you know, pip-pop-pop, pip-pip-pop, pop-pop-pop-pop, pip-pip-pop-pop.
It's going crazy.
You know, yeah, you get the picture.
Oh, yeah.
But what a speaker.
You're brilliant.
You know, 20% Steve Jobs, 10% Jesus, 50% Peter Sissons, a splash of Gandhi, don't need to measure that. If you were a quarter of the man he is, you'd be twice the man you are, and that still makes you an eighth of a very impressive man. And that's not my opinion, that's fractions.
Thank you, fractions.
OK. Time for some music. This band is the words I said to my girlfriend last week on her birthday. UB44.
I've never seen you like this. I thought it was because petrol prices have gone down.
Have they?
No.
Oh. Anyway, this guy Craig is one sod of a good MD. He wants new ideas. He said everyone's opinion is valid.
Right.
In fact, I think I've written it down somewhere. Just to say something.
Is that it?
Yeah. There. You know, he said everyone's opinions are valid, even the bin men's. Although that may have been a joke. Craig, it's Alan. Yeah, I know you're busy. I'm going to talk very fast. Just want to say I loved the meeting this morning, Craig. I sat there and I just thought, I didn't know it was actually possible to make a 9 a.m. meeting almost beautiful. And I mean that because what you'll find out about me is I don't mince my words. Any communications from me will be completely unminced. It'll be solid, but sliced. I mean, you know, manageable, but still, you know, identifiable as some sort of meat. You said you wanted ideas, and after the meeting, I was so fizzy, I decided to email you about this play I've written. And, really? Oh, Craig, that's great. Thank you. You're not going to regret this, Craig. This is really... I've written loads of episodes, Craig. I'll tell you about them another time. But the last one is very good. It's got an argument in a car park. You're busy, Craig. Craig, it's fine, you're a busy man. Craig, you're a busy man. Okay. And Craig, sorry if I've been using your name a bit too much. OK, bye, Craig. I mean, bye. You're listening to Alan Partridge.
Alan's balanced debate is genuinely balanced.
Bam! Excellent. And we're back with Cecil Phillips of the North Norfolk... Hello.
Hello.
Joined in the interest of impartiality on my left by none other than Simon Denton. Simon, I believe your girlfriend is a vegetarian.
Yes.
Great. Right. Well, Simon will be replacing his jester hat with a protester hat, which often frequently a jester's hat. Simon Denton, you oppose fox hunting. Why?
Just think it's cruel to the foxes.
Cecil Phillips, you and your mates just go around beating up wildlife for kicks.
No, well, foxes can be pretty unpleasant. I think we have a very romanticised idea of foxes. If you'd ever been in a chicken coop after a fox attack...
Yes, Simon Denton. Foxes, they're thieving bastards. If a fox was a human being, it'd be David Starkey, a real git of a guy.
They always talk about the inside of a chicken coop, but foxes are animals at the end of the day. They're not evil, they're just looking for food.
Philip, you portray these little red dogs.
No, they're not dogs.
Little red dogs. They're just trying to put a chicken dinner on the table for the cubs.
Chickens are a farmer's livelihood.
Precisely. Simon Denton, he's saying foxes are screwing the farmers, and meanwhile they're being defended by soap-dodging, meat-dodging, job-dodgers.
No, I did not say that, no.
He didn't say that. He's saying, whoa, you're putting words in my mouth big time. Back off.
No, I'm saying fox numbers need to be controlled.
Answer him.
Yeah. I just think there's an arrogance about it all.
Yeah, so Cecil, he looks at you guys in your red tunics and your tight white tights.
Jodhpurs.
And you just look like bloody pillars.
Look, I won't deny that our pageantry we take seriously, but you can't just turn up in jeans.
That's a good point.
It's not like some teenage pursuit, like Laser Quest.
You can't just turn up in jeans. Well, hang on a second. Laser Quest is not a teenage pursuit. I quest with a round tabler who served in Northern Ireland. Sometimes he gets flashbacks. I have to talk him down over a milkshake.
It's different.
If society ever breaks down, you may well regret not having been to Laser Quest, because the people who can't stand you go a lot.
I'm sure we'll cope.
Well, I think you'd be overrun by sheer weight of numbers.
Exactly. If the working classes all rise up as one, then you are done for, mate.
Yeah, you're a communist.
We have horses.
Yeah, horses... I'm sorry, in an inner-city war zone, will be all but useless.
End up roasting on a spit in the middle of the precinct.
Yeah, in some sort of post-apocalyptic vision of hell.
Yeah, where the hunter becomes the hunted.
You can run, but you can't hide. Sure, you ditch your red tunic and don a hoodie, and you blend in for a while.
But then some local grabs you and says, "All right, mate!"
Yeah, and you say, "Yeah, spiffing! Oh, wagwan!" But the game's up. By nightfall, you and Leopold are swinging from a lamppost, your bugle stuck up your backside. So the last gases escaping from your body make a bleakly comic noise. And I'm afraid that's all we've got time for, but encouraging to know that within that, you've at least found some common ground. Cecil, your dream dinner party guests.
North Norfolk Digital.
I like that one, the silencer.
Would you like to go and buy an air rifle this weekend?
Can I?
Yes, you could go shooting squirrels with the boys.
Do you think they'd like air rifles?
Definitely.
Of course, they're from a broken home. Also, of course, the protesters, what they very rarely point out, is the welfare of the beagles. Some of the abuse these dogs are subject to by these so-called law-abiding protesters. Bad dog! Bad dog! Bad dog! I mean, that's got to affect the self-esteem.
Well, do dogs have self-esteem?
Yes, Assassin, do dogs have self-esteem?
Well, you know, I wouldn't be at all surprised. They're very well-trained, highly intelligent dogs.
Yeah. Which is presumably why you use them. I mean, you're not going to get very far if you with a poodle or a...
Corgi.
A corgi.
Let's see a corgi going face to face with a fox.
absolutely shit itself. Pathetic. Well, God willing, this year you'll be left alone to rid your land of what I hear are pretty nasty animals.
Mm. And the foxes aren't great either.
Yeah, yes.
Come on, guys. You can't begrudge someone, peaceful protest.
I think he's talking about these types. Tutu a sleeping bag.
Placards.
Hanging
from
trees. Placards.
Placards with no, official font.
Exactly. They're just messed.
Squished in.
That is all bunched up. The kerning's wrong. I'd like to see them run a business. Wouldn't last for, presumably you... unless it's, is it inherited?
It's inherited.
Even better. I once inherited a clock. Beats buying them.
Well, what I would say is it's a very traditional pursuit, and it's with a very, very welcoming atmosphere.
Right. So anyone's welcome. So.
Well, within reason. I mean, we don't want to welcome any old Tom, Dick, and Harry.
Absolutely. Although Tom, Dick, and Harry, of course, very popular names amongst huntsfolk.
We have lots of names.
You can't welcome every Carl, Lee, and Barry.
Yeah, I think that's the point, isn't it? You don't want to mix too much with the... I don't suppose you know many Lees.
We have a Leopold.
Yeah, that's... Yeah, you shouldn't have said that. Time for some middle-of-the-road music. She's got diamonds and a nice big bum. It's Jennifer Lopez.
Sidekick Simon's Cryptic Confectionery.
I am chocolate placed on Saddam's head. Yes, stop shouting about my little bubbles.
Whisper?
Yes, yes. You'll be bowled over by my coloured pellets.
And the Skittles.
Skittles is right. And final question. You wait all day for one of my nougat-stroke-chocolate concoctions, then three come along at once.
Double...
Can I ask you a question, Elaine? Do you like drama on the radio?
Well, I don't see many of them, to be honest, Alan.
Then let me tell you a story. It's Boxing Day, 7 a.m, and I am in the David Lloyd showers when a muscle merchant wanders over to me and offers me some talc. I cup my hand and he gives me a mound. I pat it around, and as the plume settles, he looks at me and says, "Why is there no drama on regional radio?" I said, "Sebastian, I'm ashamed to say I don't have an answer to that question." And I ran home at top speed and wrote a play for radio. It was only the next day that I realised I'd left my car there. So.
I didn't realise you fancied yourself as a playwright.
I don't fancy myself. I'm not John Inverdale, but I've wanted to be a playwright for ages. So, Elaine, would you like to hear a radio play?
Well, yes.
Thanks, Elaine.
You
win?
Not sure.
So, please stay tuned, because later on we will be presenting the world premiere of A Chill Breeze or A Glowering Glassblower, This Way Comes, because everyone has a story in them, don't they? You have a story in you. I'm sure.
Yeah, I do. I've been trying to write a short story about how I tracked down my real mum. I wasn't surprised really at how she reacted. Mm. She's got a new family now, so I don't blame her if she doesn't want to.
Exactly. Everyone has a story in them. Right now, with the time at midday, or 12:12, let's have some music. They perfectly describe the council's proposal to build affordable housing on Greenbelt land. This is Madness. And now on North Norfolk Digital, Partridge Playhouse presents A Chill Breeze or A Glowering Glassblower, This Way Comes. Britain's cows have started lying down in different directions, causing rural panic. The government appeals for calm, but maverick scientist Jim Hannigan suspects foul play.
Professor Hannigan? Professor Hannigan?
Yes?
Are you esteemed professor, Professor Hannigan?
Last time I checked my lanyard.
That's Hannigan, sharp as a tack.
This is of the utmost secrecy. If the scientific community knew I was even approaching the man they'd ostracized, how can I be sure it's you?
You'll notice I shook your hand quite badly.
Of course. You're missing fingers.
Something to his fingers.
Hannigan's fingers are based on a guy I knew, used to work the engine crane at Longbridge, and they're supposed to wear gauntlets. But...
A London cocktail party with the cream of the world's scientific minds.
Remarkable.
Yet one still can't get a decent glass of wine. Remarkable.
John Blindmore.
Whatever happened to him?
He got caught having a bubble bath with a boy in the 90s, and so his confidence has taken a bit of a knock. But he's still very good, and his rate's gone through the floor.
Hello, Hannigan.
Professor Jim Kelvin Hannigan, if you don't mind.
So you're playing Hannigan?
Yeah. A few actors read for the part. A guy called Mark Rylance.
Yes.
Yeah, he was spectacularly good, but he wasn't Hannigan.
Professor Hawking is driving over to us now.
In the end, I got the part.
Hey, Mr. Dooley.
Oh, hello, Professor Hawking.
You know, your waistline is like the universe.
How do you mean?
It's ever expanding.
You know, the universe is ever expanding.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't have to stand for this. I'm going over there.
Nice one, Hawks. Sometimes I wish I was disabled but clever with a robot voice. We should be at my Norwich penthouse quite soon, my garlic beauty. Were it not for this damn traffic.
I cannot wait.
Traffic and travel.
Driver, turn up the radio.
Due to a major incident, all roads in and out of the south of Norwich have been shut by police.
What the hell's this?
Hello, Sarah. Do you know what the red light outside means?
No girls allowed.
Broadcasting.
Who said you could play it?
Craig, who said you could pass round a sponsorship form for your daughter's fun run?
What was that last bit?
Oh, that was just part of the drama.
But people might think it was an actual traffic report.
I've seen the way you look at me. Your eyes devour me.
What is this, anyway?
And my groin burns for you.
It's just, a romantic subplot. All good dramas have them.
I'm going to kiss you, so you'd better open your mouth very wide. Yeah.
Clear up that traffic report now, or I'll have you taken off the air.
Fine. And put me down for 50 quid if your daughter manages to heave herself round the course. I'll take that back. Actually, I've just had a traffic report on my text. It says that the only road closed into Norwich is, in actual fact, the A417. Other than that, everything's clear as a bell. Yep, that's your travel. Oh, that's nice. Let me just slip these socks off.
Slip these socks off.
You like my French underwear?
Happy now?
Take your top off.
That was Hannigan, not me.
Goodness me, you're busty.
Again, Hannigan, not me.
This is ridiculous.
Sit on my lap.
But you haven't got any knickers on.
That's okay. I discarded my underpants ages ago.
I'm going to spin on. This is Alan Partridge. We're a little short of time, so I'll summarise to the end of the scene. Hannigan and Sarah make love. Hannigan more than satisfies her. His missing fingers are no impediment to this because he has these implements that he screws on. He's got he has a toy box which he pulls out from under the bed, and I'll skip that. Next morning they wake up. They do it again. Again he satisfies her. Again the toy box. So we join them post brunch, trying to find a way around the police roadblocks, the fictional police roadblocks.
We need to get to the field with the lying down cows. I'm going to go off-road.
I do all the animal noises.
Are you sure the cow will manage it?
You've never driven a Range Rover, have you? It's pretty much the only car you'll ever need. Range Rover.
Wait a sec, are you promoting Range Rover?
No. No, I'm not promoting Range Rover. Now, I know the rules. The guy happens to drive a Range Rover. End of.
So what do you think of the Range Rover, anyway?
In a word...
ambivalent.
I've never felt so...
neutral.
...about a car.
And how much do they cost?
Less than you might think. You can drive one off the forecourt for 20... ...to pay for 3 years.
Alan, I've spoken to Craig. You've got one more minute and then it comes off.
Fine. Hello, I'm going to spool on to the final scene. It's a press conference. The next day, Dooley thinks he's going to humiliate Hannigan, but Hannigan is ready to play his ace. It's ace. Listen.
And in conclusion, I can now end this press conference by saying there is no proof whatsoever of alien life. And if there are no more questions, this press conference will end in 5, 4, 3... Two.
There is one, actually.
What? Damn it. It's Hannigan.
If someone did produce evidence, wouldn't that prove you quite wrong?
Where is this evidence?
It's here, in this jar.
Good God.
Like some fucking jelly with eyes.
And so the plot, like hot gravy, thickens. Let us know what you think of a chill wind or a glowering glass view. You know the rest. And yes, the inbox has gone crazy. Best play ever, says Jill. John in North Walsham says, I'm sure at the idea stage it was great. Thanks very much, John.
And Toby in Walsham says, I think theatre is just for puffs and women.
Yeah, well, it's not for everyone, but do keep your views coming in. Now, though, some music. This is Various Artists. Okay, and if the gunman was behind him and the book depository was how far away?
180 feet.
180 feet.
Then the bullet would have reached the president before the sound of the bang.
Well, that makes sense. But circling back to your theory that he was killed by the Scottish Secret Service...
No, that's the last guy. This isn't Jews.
Ah, yes. You're saying he was killed by a gang of Jews.
Spot on.
Okay. And sorry, remind me, this is because...
Well, let's go back to the Old Testament. If you look at the Book of Exodus...
I'm going to cut you short there, Bill. I think it's a fantastic theory. In the meantime, if anyone wants to join our spin-off debate on ballistics and field weaponry, please head to the North Norfolk Digital chat room. I'm normally there from 3 p.m. to the wee small hours.
North Norfolk Digital is available anywhere in the world. It's global radio with an Anglian swagger, bringing Norwich to Nigeria, Swaffham to Scotland, and Cromer to the Kremlin.
Svenja!
Well,
it's a chilling thought, though, isn't it, that that Cromer might one day fall to the Russians.
Sounds like a Frederick Forsyth novel in the making.
Yeah, the Norfolk Fracture.
The Red Peninsula.
Yes, that sounds quite alarming, doesn't it? The seaside town of Cromer has fallen to the Russians.
Mm. All roads to Cromer are now closed.
This is not a drill. Repeat, this is not a drill.
I'd read it.
I would. Music. There's some kids outside playing snowballs, but they've forgotten to put their parkas on. It's cold play. I used to have a parka. I miss parkas.
You should buy one then.
I'm going to. It's Thursday, which means it's Mid-Thursday Morning Matters Book Club, or...
Mid-Thursday Morning Matters Book Club.
A virtual get-together where we talk about a book we've read that week. Saul Harris can't be with us. So in his stead slash shoes, we have Rosie Witter.
Hello.
Webcam voyeurs may recognise Rosie as our resident wine expert.
I am indeed.
Have you been drinking this morning?
No.
A little snifter before you left the house?
No!
I don't believe you. Did you bring any wine?
Oh, I do have a bottle with me.
That's my girl! That's Rosie Witter. Joining us on the phone, we have Edith in Rackheath. Hello, Edith.
Hello.
And on email, we're joined by Andrew in Docking. Are you there, Andrew?
Andrew says yes.
Excellent. And in the studio, I, Partridge. That's the club. Let's get to the knob.
Right. Well, I've never hosted a book club quite like this.
It's no exaggeration to say that this is the very first multi-platform radio-based book club broadcast in the whole of East Anglia.
We're dragging book clubs into the 21st century, kicking and screaming.
Yeah, sounds painful.
Not like an abduction, more like a child who doesn't want to be measured for new shoes. Rosie.
Right, so the book to read this week was Wild Swans by Yung Chang, and I hope you've all managed to finish it.
Yeah, we have, and if you haven't, just order it off Amazon.
Or a different website that pays its taxes.
Come on. It's a good business model. Cheap books, happy shareholders, and the boss is stinking rich. Hats off.
With questionable practices.
Simon, you can't please all the people all the time. That's what China tried to do. Look what happened there. Now you can only have one baby. And if it's a girl, tough luck.
Which moves us nicely onto Wild Swans.
Does it? Yeah. Next you'll be complaining that Amazon make people in their warehouses run too quickly to fetch books. It's not a call centre in Timbuktu. They're students. You can't mistreat students.
All that running around. Yeah. You could do with a bit of that, Alan. Help me lose a few pounds.
Off. But Rosie makes a good point. You know, you would slow down deliveries in the short term, but you know, in the long term, you know, you'd tackle one of the biggest killers of our times.
Shipping.
Obesity.
You could have them running around for books that don't exist.
<That's cruel. laughs>
Babysitting by King Herod.
That's
Marriage Guidance by Henry VIII.
Or Losing at Squash Gracefully by Anne Diamond. So, do get in touch if you have any other ideas, because I'm going to make unlikely book titles today's quality question.
Oh, that is quality.
Well, it looks like Mummy P and Baby P have finally pushed Daddy P too far. It's the Black Eyed Peas. Let's clear the air. The real reason people have a go at Bernie Eccleston is because he has the first name of a dinner lady and he goes out with giant women.
What about the fact that he cozies up to dictators and torturers?
He's not a torturer.
No, he does business with torturers.
Precisely. But he's so small he could barely pick up a cattle prod. You know, he wears kids' clothing. Watch out for him next time there's a wet Grand Prix. His wellies have got Spider-Man on.
Yeah, but you can't explain his highly convoluted tax arrangements.
No, which is why we have to...
Shut up and move on.
Now, we're all familiar with charities, from the important ones, like the National Trust, to less important ones, like Help the Aged.
Or Help for Heroes.
No, that's the top one.
Yep.
Yes. I donated a jacket to them only last week. It didn't have an arm, but then I thought, you know, perfect. But today we're going local, and we mean to raise £3,000 for Addiction Action. Addiction can take many forms, from booze to drugs to, quite simply, having it off.
Michael Douglas.
Yes, that's indeed, if it was sex addiction, it could quite simply have been the guy was very, very randy. That's £3,000 by 2 p.m, and if we don't quite get there, I'll make up the difference myself. What do we got?
We've got our first pledge. Gary in Aylsham says he's trying to sell his old-style Volkswagen Beetle called Gertie, and if he can get £400 for it, he'll donate it all to our appeal.
That's very generous. Volkswagen Beetle drivers were always...
characters.
...well-meaning fools. And... here are you two, who seem to be describing my search for a new washer-dryer. I still haven't found what I'm looking for. It's a top loader in black.
Right. I didn't know you were into your charities.
I wasn't, but it's a great brand builder, yeah. You do your bit for charity, you get what Richard Curtis calls goodwill splashback.
Oh, like a good karma.
Yeah, yeah. He explained it to me the other day. He said, this is for you, and now this is for me.
Malky flogged Lego for half a p apiece. Skaggs, his poison.
Janie's story. I live rough on the streets of Norwich.
Janie used to be a teacher. Now she's a bum with booze in her veins.
Tristram's story.
I started taking coke when I first became a hedge fund manager.
Tristram missed out on his bonus last year. His dreams of a bigger house in tatters.
Thank you, Alan.
Thank you, Alan.
Thanks, Al, for putting your hands across Norfolk.
Mmm, bananas and cream. I can't beat it. OK, you're listening to Mid-Morning Masses. Today we're raising £3,000, or £1,300, for Norwich-based charity Action Addiction. Sorry, Addiction Action. Got some banana in my mouth.
Swallow.
Okay, Simon, what's the tot-up?
Yeah, well, we're looking good. We are already at 610 English pounds.
Put that in context for any listening addicts.
Yep, that is roughly 150 pints of lager or 8 grams of coke.
And in terms of heroin?
Just checking, I've asked one of the cleaners.
The Scottish guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good. And hey, what a great bunch of listeners. I mean, I think I stepped on a hornet's nest last year when I suggested Norwich was ready for a black town crier, but you cannot fault their generosity. OK, online now we have an addict who wishes to remain anonymous, so we've disguised their voice. Hello, caller. What's your story?
I'm addicted to gambling.
The sound guy said it'd be fine.
I'm up to my eyes in debt. My marriage is in bits. I've lost my job selling wool at the market. Sorry, I'm getting quite emotional.
It's all right, mate. Take your time. So, your wife had left you?
My husband. I'm a woman.
Of course. Sorry. Yes, of course. Men don't sell wool. Listen, love, I think we're going to have to cut this short. The voice distorter's bending your gender. It's also making you sound like a villain from a faraway galaxy. Could you simply say, soon your planet will be mine?
Soon your planet will be mine.
Yeah, yeah, I think we're going to have to leave it there. OK. Quick clarification, there's been some panic at a care home with listeners worried that Russia has taken over Chroma. That's my fault for making it sound like a news report. The Russians have not taken over Chroma.
That we know of.
Not yes. I mean, it could have infiltrated the council years ago.
It has certainly explained their attitude to parking enforcement.
Yeah, well, that's more Nazis, isn't it? But it's all evil. It's all evil. Wild Swans, Rosie. It's a long book.
Well, it is substantial, yes. So Wild Swans follows the lives of three generations of Chinese women. It's a true story of Yung Chang and her mother and her grandmother.
Well, that's certainly what I took from it.
Well, that's what it's about.
No, I mean, absolutely spot on, spot on. But let's keep talking.
So, first impressions?
Let me stop you and go to Edith. What do you think?
Three from me.
OK. Anything from... Andrew, yet Simon?
No, not yet, but I gave it a three. Okay. And I've got a few fours coming in via text. I've got Meredith in Hunstanton says 4.5, and Cynthia says she would also give it a three.
So I'm not familiar.
Out of five, always out of five. So average it out, Simon, and what's the mean score?
Done it. It's 3.6.
Oh, there you go, 3.6, not bad. So that was Wild Geese, the fascinating Swans. Story. Swans, my mistake, about four generations of Chinese.
Three generations.
Women. Is it?
Yeah, it was three.
My mistake.
Andrew's saying two.
What, generations?
No, I think that's his score, I think.
Andrew, is that your score or the number of generations of Chinese women you think it is? It'll just be a second. Can you email him? Just,
yeah.
Is that your score or the number of generations of Chinamen? Gotta move on. The time is AM11. Our thanks to Beverly in Kingsland. She sent in a beef sponge. She says it's a great way to use up bits of old beef. It's essentially chunks of beef suspended in a kind of matrix of pastry, sort of hovering in a...
Sponge stasis.
Yeah, good name for the dish, actually. Sponge stasis, brackets, beef edition. Looks almost as good as last week's chicken drizzle cake. Maybe I have some of that later. Partridge, he got game. OK, before that, the book club, Rosie.
Hi.
Edith.
Hello.
And Andrew. We were discussing Wild Swans, a book that garnered an impressive 3.6.
And Andrew has given the book a 2, by the way, and says Edith must have been reading a different book.
He always does this. My score is nothing to do with him.
Right.
A bit pathetic, actually.
Oh. Rosie, 3.6, a fair score?
Hard to say. at the book club I run, we try to avoid scoring or ranking books.
Right, so it's more of a coffee morning.
No. We do discuss the book, but we focus more on how we thought or felt. Ranking can be a little reductive.
Well, it can be, but you might like to know that Wild Swans ranked number 2 on our book league table.
Oh.
Yeah. A nose ahead of Angels and Demons by Dan Brown, but a whisker behind... The Da Vinci Code by Dan Brown. So you split the Browns.
A brown sandwich.
Yeah, this sounds like something Beverly would knock up. Right, Wild Swans.
Yes.
Brian in Dursingham emails to say, who on earth wants to read a book about Chinese swans?
It's a metaphor.
A far better book is The Wild Geese, about a snatched squad of steel-hard mercenaries who rescue a black king or something from deepest, darkest Africa. Thanks, Brian. Always good to hear from you. Butter old women.
Bitter old woman, I think. Typing too fast.
Yeah, although you can butter up old women. I sometimes butter up old women.
Andrew is just a bully who hides behind his laptop. How come he never dares speak on the phone? What's he got to hide?
He could be an 8-year-old boy. Child genius.
Yeah, angry because he's been hothoused by his parents.
It does happen. Denied a childhood.
Yeah, Andrew, if that is you... get outside, climb a few trees.
Pull a few wheelies.
Scuff your knees.
Yeah, collect loads of chewing gum wrappers and send off for a free torch. Sorry, Rosie, you were saying.
No, I was just saying, I think the swans is a metaphor for the women.
I love metaphors. I really got into them a couple of years ago. And now, if I read a title that's too literal, it actually annoys me. I mean, if I went to see Moonraker, I don't want to see James Bond actually raking the moon. Unless he had some sort of industrial equipment. And even then, he's going to need a damn good reason.
I think The Wild Swans is a strong metaphor. I mean, there's something impassive and hard to read about swans, isn't there? Like the women, they're beautiful, but they're unknowable.
They're inscrutable.
That's exactly the right word.
Is it?
Yes.
Thank you.
You couldn't scrute them if you wanted
to. Don't ruin it. Let's have some music. This is Thatcher Pop four-piece Duran Duran. I got a smashing flavour. Still here with book club leader Rosie Witter.
Hello.
I just love reading books. It's brilliant.
I couldn't live without it.
I couldn't either. My partner Angela prefers television. I mean, she will watch literally anything. But if I go up and ask her what she's been watching, she doesn't know. Odd.
Mm, well, it's a good book for me every time. Curl up on the sofa.
Yes, take the phone off the hook.
Yeah, maybe a tower of hot buttered crumpets, sleeping bag tied off around your waist.
Like a giant maggot.
Yeah, well, half a maggot, because the other half's a Warwick University sweatshirt.
And no interruptions.
Perhaps the strains of Jean-Michel Jarre haunting you from the music centre. I mean, it's on, there's nothing paranormal. And then just plough headlong into Wild Swan's news. I did actually plough into a swan many years ago, yeah. It was, it's the only time I actually ever heard a swan quack. Pardon me. It's mid-Thursday, it's mid-morning, it's mid, he does it.
Thursday Morning Matters, book club.
So, any final thoughts? What did you take from the book? Alan?
I read the book, and I thought it was a good book. Mm-hmm. It's about people, isn't it? Chinese women with small feet. And what's all that about?
Well, it is. It's all explained in the book.
Shit, I haven't read the book. I'm sorry. You angry?
No, not at all. We will find some books heavy going. I myself actually gave up on The Diary of Anne Frank on my first attempt. I couldn't get through it.
And again, neither could she.
You're angry. Have some beef swans. Wait till he's right behind your shoulder and then, you know, feign fear if it helps. And then if you feel the back of your arm, just the little knobbly bone there, if he's right up behind you, just into his ribs, into his ribs, and then bang, back of the hand and bust his nose. I know when you were fooling around in the kitchen with Jez before, it was just a bit of tomfoolery, but I just thought when I saw you doing this and this, I just thought, we got to talk. Anyway, that's it. It's 12:30 and we're joined by Derek Bosworth, who's here to tell us all about handheld, bellows-driven reed instruments. Sounds like a real wheeze. Before that, some pledges on the texts.
We do have some pledges. Jed from Ipswich says he has a 10-year-old Mondeo 1.8. He wants £500 and will give 50 to the appeal.
OK. Phil in Glanford says, leave Porsche drivers with red faces with my tweaked VW Golf. Reluctant sale due to baby. He wants 10 grand cash, with 60 for charity.
And one here from Dennis in Feltwell, 2012 Lexus GS, first to see will buy, no time wasters.
Right, and what's the donation?
I don't think he said.
OK. Time for the weather.
Weather update.
You know, I said I'd take Angela to Centre Parks and buy her a bigger telly. Pockets aren't that deep.
Yeah, I know.
No, it's really, I don't have that kind of money, you know? It's not, I'm out of my depth. How could they raise £4,000 for a donkey sanctuary? Ridiculous.
People like donkeys.
Why? We've got cars.
I'm not saying I like...
They don't work, they should put them down. All right, Dave. It's Dave Clifton. He's been through the mill. He was a massive boozer. You know the story about him? No? I shouldn't say this because he's moved on, but when he was really completely at rock bottom, he actually ended up down at the docks pleasuring a vagrant. Yeah. All right, Dave. Just talking about your checkered past.
Oh, did you tell him about the time I wanked off those tramps?
Yeah. That was plural, wasn't it?
Must have been a line of them.
That's some sort of diabolical soup kitchen.
Alan Partridge's hands across the county.
Dave, what would you say was the lowest of the low? And before you do answer that, I should add that the pledge line is still open, so do call.
Please!
Well,
The lowest lows often follow the highest highs. And as you know, Alan, I was the biggest DJ in Norfolk with the number one show on the station.
Well, it depends on the metric.
I was a star. I had a semi-detached home, a Vauxhall Tigra, and I deserved it. Yeah. I took my eye off the ball. Yes, I had the number one show on the station.
Yeah, it depends on the metric.
But then I entered a spiral.
Right, now is this when you were stuck on a water slide with your jeans still on?
No, no, a spiral of addiction.
Of course.
I'd drink anything. It affected my judgment.
Right, good. Okay, now, Dave, what was the worst thing you did? God help us.
Oh, you mean the tramps?
Yeah, no, God, no. What, one rung below that?
Oh. I remember once I broke into someone's back garden and had a fight with a snowman. You know, I had so much premium lager coursing through me, I thought he was from the council.
It's good to see you laugh, Dave.
Oh, you've got to laugh, Alan.
Although tears sometimes help. Tears can help. Tears would help.
I've done all my crying, Alan. I like to think I'm a barrel of laughs, because a barrel of tears is good for nothing.
Yeah, well, it's just a bucket of brine, isn't it? It's great that you're upbeat, Dave, but it could do with being a little bit sadder.
My glass is always half full, Alan.
Wasn't that the problem?
You've got a son, haven't you?
Oh, don't go there, Alan. You get me going.
I can imagine. I think someone once told me that he swapped his scale extract for some cocaine on Christmas Day.
Well, it was a packet of Daz, as it turned out. Yeah, I always joke, actually, about that, Alan, that I got cleaned out. it is really sad.
You don't sound sad. You don't sound sad. Be sad. You're listening to Alan Partridge.
There is a reason I don't talk about my son. Well, you wouldn't talk about it, would you? If your son came up to you and said, Dad, will you put me on your shoulders so I can pick the apples from the tree for apple pie and custard? And I say, no, son, because I'm pissed. And then I say, I've got an even better idea, son. Why don't we play this new game? It's called Invisible Dad, where someone who looks exactly like me lies on the sofa all afternoon watching Bargain Hunt, while the real me, Invisible Dad, will come out into the back garden in 5 minutes' time and we'll play together all afternoon, son, quietly. But I'm on the sofa half an hour later and I can hear my little boy out in the garden talking to no one. And do you know what I did? I turned up the volume to drown him out with David Dickinson.
Oh, God.
Fast forward 2 years, and I'm sitting in a room with a circle of chairs, and I'm saying, my name's Tom Barrington, and I'm an alcoholic.
Sorry, who's Tom Barrington?
That's my real name.
You changed your name to Dave Clifton?
Yeah, yeah. Fast forward again to a summer's day last year, I've got my son on my shoulders saying, Daddy, Daddy, I can reach the apples. And all I could think was, so can I, son. So can I. And that's what I do, Alan. Every day I just try and reach the apples.
Thank you, Dave. I used to think you were a right Burke, but I realise now that's only half the story.
Thank you.
And I'll tell you something else. I hope you keep reaching those apples every day. Because... And if you can't find it in your hearts to find 3K for a guy like Dave Clifton, then I won't bother coming in tomorrow. Because I'll be at an orchard behind Dave Clifton on a bicycle with a basket full of apples. And then we'll go home, and together we'll bake an apple pie and feed it to his son. And I'll tell you something else, Dave.
What?
I'm bringing the custard. What's it doing? The time is 12:45.
Hugs are not drugs.
Cuddles, not Ruddles. Oh my God, I'm sorry, I completely forgot about you. Sorry.
La, 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 and the paint's peeling up on my walls. La, 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 there's a man outside.
La, la, la. Could you be more specific?
In a long cone grey hat, smoking a cigarette.
We are nearly out of time. Simon, top me up.
Money!
Well, the final, rather grand total is £2,970.
So, £30 short.
Yep.
I'll pay that.
Yep.
Absolutely. Love you, Norfolk. News.
The headlines this lunchtime.
You got 30p?
You've got it there.
I need that for a Milky Way.
I mean, I've got one in my lunchbox. You can have that.
Let's have a look. Right.
Yep.
Earlier I played Meatloaf's I'd Do Anything for Love, but I won't do that. And we asked, what would you not do for love? Sandra in Beccles.
Shave my dad's back.
Barry in Kelling.
Give kidney.
Leonard in Taverham.
Put her on the car insurance.
A lot of you are saying that. Tara in Westwick.
Tell my sweeties.
And Beth in Paston.
Renounce Christ.
Keep those calls coming in. The winning answer receives a year's supply of meatloaf. That's one loaf a week for a year, provided exclusively for this show by Bannon's the Butchers. They don't say what kind of meat it is, but when I press them, they said it will vary from week to week. This is Mid-Morning Matters.
Hey, you! What do you want?
A friendly voice.
I listen to Mid-Morning Matters. It's fantastic radio.
Me love Alan Partridge. The man is fresh, man.
Shep loves it too, man.
Now, his kids may have two dads, but his music meets with everyone's approval. It's Elton John. Sorry about the speed wash. Still recovering from this morning's workout.
Oh, what was that? Boxer size?
Love making with Angela. Whew. I mean, she's no Vogue model, and she's not even a catalogue model, but she is strong and she has stamina. Have you ever been out with a woman with a rough tongue? It doesn't matter. I've said too much. But no, I've been up since four, sweating like a Mexican bandit at the end of a spaghetti western.
The good, the bad, and the ugly.
No, it's not a bad description of what went on, because there were three distinct phases. She was pissed. You're listening to Alan Partridge on Mid-Morning Matters. That was Tapow, which is Yorkshire for the pow. It's Gangster Day. Ah, Jesus! On North Norfolk Digital, we're asking you today to tell me how hot you should have your bath. Which ties in rather nicely with yesterday's competition, in which we asked you what is the best way to dispose of a body. We had some pretty good answers.
We've had some pretty good answers, Alan. Concrete boot, minced and fed to pigs, dropped into the foundations of a new build, or minced and fed to dogs.
Like. Yeah, pigs are better.
Of course, if you really want to lose a body, then just post it to yourself, special delivery.
they do their best. They do their best. Coming up soon, we'll be chatting to a former gang member. Do you like gangs, Simon?
Yes, I do, Alan. I like the old East End gangs from the 60s.
Yeah, lovable rogues.
Yeah, diamond geezers.
I love diamond geezers.
Yeah, me too. No, they break the law and you don't mind.
Exactly. It's not like the benefit cheats. You know, they're like the people saying, oh, I can't operate heavy machinery because I've got a nervous disposition. You know, liars. And they only attack their own, to be fair, or nonces, or grasses. I'll give you a jolly good hiding and pop you in the boot of the jag.
Push it into the Thames.
Precisely.
So they drown.
Well, you would, wouldn't you? This is one diamond geezer who would never dream of pulling your fingernails off with a pair of pliers. It's Neil.
Diamond.
Yeah, they know.
What would life be without cars? What would life be without trees? What would life be without oceans? What would life be without bees?
Sounds like one of Alan's phone-ins.
That's actually true. Yeah. Lovely song.
Thank you.
Lovely
really
song.
Nice.
If you just joined us, we are in session live with the a legendary folk singer, Blackbird Goodbrook. Is that how you pronounce it?
Yes, Blackbird. It's a nickname. A lot of people call me Blackbird or Blackie, BB. My girlfriend calls me BBGB, but that's, you know, pet name, stays within the walls of the cottage.
Well, that's funny. But I mean, I call my girlfriend, I call her Little Sparrow. She calls me Big Bird, and I, you know, waddle in and fall on her. But, I mean, she's fine, she's part of it.
He's literally got a crush on her.
But no, in all seriousness, you know, a robust physical appetite between two healthy adults, you know, can mushroom into real love.
Really great song, that, though, Blackbird.
Well, thanks.
Really
Thank you. I was just trying to get across the point that in the race for the new, a lot of people forget what's important.
EGBs.
Didn't they do Saturday Night Fever?
A lot of people think they're a nuisance, but all animals are vital to the ecosystem, even bacteria.
Yeah, I know what you mean about bees, but bacteria, come on.
Pull the other one.
I mean, no, seriously, because I mean, I have a bath once a week with a cap full of Dettol, and that's non-negotiable. You know, I like to come downstairs knowing there's nothing alive on me.
But we're all God's creatures.
Granted, but you know, if we keep putting ourselves last all the time, we're going to wake up one morning and find we've been usurped by apes.
Did you watch Dawn of the Planet of the Apes last night, Alan?
Yeah. But, you know, I'm not saying we're definitely going to be taken over by apes.
You're saying that we may be taken over by apes.
Be vigilant. Yeah. Let's talk about your music. Blackbird.
Yeah.
Blackie.
Blackbird.
Yeah, Blackbird. Until I saw you perform so beautifully the other night in the Boxley Wheat Sheaf, I would have said that all folk music was the soundtrack to a harvest. But I think your music's that good it could be used on an advert.
Thank you. Hopefully not advert.
The comforting, gentle voiceovers. Oh, hello. Have a wee drum.
Although people in Scotland don't really speak like that, do they? I think it'd be more accurate to have someone just saying, you know, jump to Scotland if you fancy it. Yeah. What? You try and walk round him. What's the matter? You say, nothing's the matter. I just want to go back to my hotel. Let's have some music. This is Status Quo. Yeah, thanks. It's Italian. Actually, I bought it in Capri. Yeah, guess how much it cost?
60 quid.
£1,000 in 1980. Yeah, but you're not paying for the leather. You're paying for the lining. I mean, no one sees it, but I sometimes throw it over the back of the chair on the train. Let people, let them see the money.
Folk music's always been seen as old-fashioned. There's no synthesizers, there's no samplers.
Easter baddies.
It's always been about reaching local people for me. The stadiums were never for me. I leave that for the likes of...
Trapping.
Yeah. They make the monkeys sound like the Beatles.
They make actual monkeys sound like the Beatles.
They make actual monkeys sound like actual Beatles.
Yeah. Yeah. Blackbird, want to play a song?
Love to. This one's called The Thresher's Farewell. Picture the scene. The Sussex Downs. A young boy, nay, a young man with...
Sorry, I'm going to have to interrupt you there, Blackbird, for traffic and travel. Sorry, my mistake.
OK, no worries.
It's a great song.
Thanks.
I heard this the other night. To summarise, grumpy town, kid goes missing, town pulls together, kid never found, but when wind blows, sounds like kid singing.
More or less, yeah, but it's moving, you know. Yeah.
Unlike the traffic on the A47.
Traffic and travel, sponsored by Castrol.
That was Beyoncé's mum, Tina Turner. More of your emails on what you would not do for love. Derek says the car boot sale this Saturday. In brackets, and that's the end of it. What would you not do for love?
Patricia emails saying Miss Church / watch Blue Movie.
I'm sure she's great with the kids.
Bannon's the Butchers, the housewife's choice for bulk buying meat.
That man's voice is dripping with dripping.
You like me to play a song, Alan?
Yeah, that's why you're here.
Name me a hero. Just the intro.
Oh, okay.
Just name a hero.
Superman.
Another one?
George Osborne. No, He-Man.
I'll give you one.
Good.
This is a guy called Jeff.
who was just an ordinary guy, nothing special. And he was involved in the Norfolk floods of 1997. Do you remember those?
Yeah.
Well, Jeff was involved in the floods too, but he didn't look outside for a hero. He looked inside himself, and boy, did he answer that call. This is called Raindrops and Rainbows. It goes a little something like this. Rained and it rained and it rained and it rained and it rained some more. A thousand tiny tears come and floating underneath my door. Jeff saved them all from heaven. March 19th, 1997.
Brilliant. You're listening to Mid-Morning Matters. Blackbird, I've written down a word on my notepad. It's the only word I've written. I'd like you to read it out.
Spellbinding.
That's what that song was to me.
Thank you very much. I was just telling a true story about a guy I knew, Jeff Tanner.
Not the Jeff Tanner who was arrested. Lives in the old rectory, was accused of keeping images of children.
He was never charged at that.
Yeah, but mud sticks. I shouldn't really have mentioned his name. At least he didn't mention his address.
He did.
Oh, no, yes, he did. He said he lived at the old rectory. I've done it again. It just shows you, doesn't it? I mean, you know, paedophiles can be heroes. So, you know, if there are any well-meaning vigilantes thinking of bowling up to the old rectory to, you know, teach him a lesson.
Go easy on him.
Yeah, I mean,
because he did rescue all those Cub Scouts.
Yeah.
What?
The song was more about a gentler time, perhaps.
1997.
Yeah, when terrorists were Irish.
It's hard to find a quiet moment in the modern world because of the many distractions.
Oh, you know. I know exactly what you mean. Well, you can get bogged down, can't you, with the busyness of life. Yeah. You've got gas bills on the doormat and, you know, pizza menus, Lib Dem leaflets, Oxfam demanding a direct debit. No! You know, an invoice from the window cleaner. I'll pay you at the end of the month. And you think, how can I escape this madness? But, no, but it sounds like you've
cracked
got it licked.
Thank you very much. All I ever wanted was for my music to connect with people. So.
Blackbird Bluetooth.
I don't know about that when it comes to technology. I'm a bit of a Luddite, really.
So. Yeah, well, nothing wrong with being a Luddite.
No, this place is crawling with them.
Yeah, we were giving a talk, weren't we, on DAB radio. One of the producers went bananas, attacked a mic. Now, when I get home tonight, I'm going to throw away my kettle. Let's have a last song.
Okay.
I like the one about bees.
Oh, we could do a new one. I've got a fun song about a shepherd who moves to the city. It's upbeat, quirky, and it's called Boomtown.
Yeah, could do that one. I like the one about bees.
What would life be without iPads?
Better!
What would life be without cows?
Worse!
What would life be without Tesco's? Better!
Better!
What would life be without beer?
Worse! John in Beckles!
Food!
Worse! Jess in Horsford!
Tax!
Better! Diane in Grimston!
Gore-Tex!
Worse! Jess in Horsford!
Immigration!
Neutral!
It's complicated!
Mick in Borsham!
Marmite!
Whoa! Oh, very, very, always very, North Norfolk Digital. This is Mid-Morning Matters, where North Norfolk natters. I'm joined by former gangster, hoodlum baddie and ne'er-do-well, Julius Scanner. Good to meet you.
Good to meet you.
Right, I was expecting something extra. Julius, you try to...
Well, really, what it is just about giving kids something to do, you know? In the centre, we set up a lot of groups for them, so, you know, things like sports groups or dance groups. You
dance
know.
Is good, dancing's cool.
Okay, well, you like to dance, yeah?
Yeah, sure. Look, yeah, disco, rumba, zumba, conga, rock and roll. Yeah, yeah, just close my eyes, go with it.
Like you did at the Christmas party?
Like I did at the Christmas party.
Well, you know, it would be good to see you on a dance floor, you know, doing your thing.
Yeah, well, I was in the zone. Yeah, I was in the dance zone. The dance floor. It's not the same thing if you're at the bar or outside the toilets where people just push past you with wet hands.
Yeah, maybe you should give us a bit of a demo, Alan.
Yeah, well, my philosophy is pretty simple. Kick off your shoes, big gulp of juice, see what happens. And I've got to say, normally, if I can keep my discipline, I'm pretty pleased with the results.
I mean, it's not dancing per se. I mean, it's more sort of a collection of spasms.
Simon's funny. I call him the dancing chicken.
Yeah, well, it's not a chicken, is it? I'm doing a robot there.
No, I mean, you lack the guts to commit to real dance.
Right, so I'm a chicken.
Yeah, dancing chicken.
Whereas he stands there with this very sort of stony expression.
I have a bit of respect for my dancing circle. Drumming. That's a good way to get rid of excess aggression. And that's why Phil Collins got into it, because he's a real hothead, but then a lot of bald people are.
Well, that's not really our focus, you know. We're trying to move away from that aggression and, you know, let these kids use their brain. Eh?
Again, Collins, all over. I have a bomber jacket from the No Jacket Required tour, 85, and the jacket actually has on it No Jacket Required, written on a jacket. And a lot of people see that as hypocritical. And they get quite angry. But do you know what I think it is?
Irony.
Brilliant. Just brilliant.
Yeah, well, our kids, they use digital samples and drum machines.
Yeah, okay. Cool. I don't want to get into a whole debate about the whole drum machines versus kits. My philosophy on this is real simple. If it's got a good beat, it's got a good beat.
Exactly.
Let's do slap hands. And then one down here. And then that one. Outstanding. This is Toto. How hot should you have your bath? Sandra on line 3.
I'll make my husband have a cold bath every night to stop him fiddling with himself in bed.
Makes sense. Bobby, line 5.
50.
50 what?
Bye, Alan.
Lucian on line 6. I said I don't want to speak to someone called Lucian. Simon, text.
Yes. Marcus says it should be the same temperature they make the swimming pool when the disabled kids go in.
Lovely. Coming up, more from Julius. A reformed character, unlike Gary Glitter. You want to be in my gang? No thanks, Gary.
Yeah, well, you know, the thing is that when it comes to crime, you know, I'll be honest with you, you know, people listen to me just purely on the basis that, you know, I've been there, I've done it, you know.
You're a scum.
Well, I just got in with a bad crowd, you know. It was a lot of stealing, a lot of violence, you know. Yeah, I admit, I was a bit of a bad boy.
Yeah, scum.
Yeah.
It's a horrible word. Yeah. I mean, I don't use it, he does.
Well, no, that was in the heat of the moment. Someone had peed in my car.
Well, you know, the point is, you know, I just think that I can use, you know, my experiences just to, you know, educate people, let people know what's going on.
Yeah, I mean, I'm the same. I've had a few scrapes with the law, don't you worry about that. I've also had a few dinners with him too. A friend of mine's a chief inspector. He drink drives, but then he can.
So who's that?
Brian does the pub quiz.
He's a copper, is he?
Yeah, DCR Tollsmoor. 2 weeks ago, they found him asleep in his car on the roundabout. Do you know him?
No, I don't know him. But, you know, I know quite a few people like him, you know. Some good cops, you know, some are dodgy.
Yeah, he's not dodgy. I mean, he's a very good cop. I mean, he cuts corners.
Then drink drivers do.
Yeah. Well, you know, it just goes to show that, you know, anyone can fall foul of the law. You know, it can happen that easy.
I know it can happen that easily. I mean, when I was back in the day, when I was a kid at school, put some money in a vending machine for a Kit Kat. There was a malfunction. I got delivered 3 Kit Kats. And these were the 5-fingered kind, Julius. Now, you and I know when you've received excess confectionery, you contact the manufacturer or you call a cop. I didn't. I kept them. I wanted those fingers inside me, Julius. All 5 of them. 3 times.
Like a chocolate fist?
Yeah. I knew it was wrong, but I still did it.
The chocolate fist?
Yeah, I wanted them inside me. And it felt good, even though I knew it was wrong.
From a chocolate fist.
That's right. News and travel coming up, but time for a quick text on how hot you should have your bath. Frank Bannister in Blickling says a bath should be hot enough to gradually poach an egg. Time for news.
Your headlines this lunchtime. Norfolk County.
Talking of bath temps, you want to make sure you don't end up in hot water yourself.
What do you mean?
The chocolate fist thing. Grow up, mate.
Okay.
Cool. I don't see my phone.
What kind is it?
Mobile. It's just gone AWOL. Well, not AWOL, it's gone missing. Well, not missing, you know, just, in fact, forget about it. These things always turn up, don't they, Simon?
Yes, like the half a stone you lost last month.
Yeah, we're not on air.
Do you want me to check over here?
No, God, no. Forget it. Scrap it, scrim it. That's not even a word. I mean, phone schmoan, it's insured.
Mm. People get so hung up on phones.
Yeah, we're not on air. I could really murder a pop right now.
A what?
I could really use a pop right about now. Do you want a pop on me, Julius? Do you want a fizzy drink, Julius?
No, thanks. I'm all right.
Brian. Brian, I'm sorry. It was a joke. Okay, Brian, stand away from the fruit machine. I can't tell what you're saying. Cool it. I'm sorry. Okay. All right. Now, all right. Are you still all right for the quiz on Monday? No, I'll pick you up. No, I want to. Okay, ciao. That guy should not be a serving police officer.
I was in and out of prison for 5 years and I didn't want to keep doing it again and again, you know. I thought, you know, now I've got to change.
I was the same with Kit Kats. You know, today it was Kit Kats, but tomorrow...
Yorkies.
Yeah. No, you know, I mean, fast forward 10 years in the future, you know.
A big Easter egg.
Yeah, no, just, you're banned from this conversation. No,
but, you know, I'll tell you where it all ends, Alan, truthfully. It's, you know, it's guns, it's drugs, it's knives, you know. People end up getting hurt.
But knives are never going to go away, Julian. They're never going to go away. We had knives you wouldn't believe, Julian. Julius. These were European military.
Swiss Army knives.
Yeah. I mean, these bad boys weren't just knives. They were tin openers. They were bottle openers. They were nail files.
Tweezers.
Screwdrivers, Phillips and flathead.
Yes, but you changed. I changed.
But
and that's
change.
Exactly the message I'm trying to get across, you know, that
never again.
We can actually break this cycle of crime.
Good. And I applaud that with both hands.
Thank you. And, you know, that's why I continue to do talks with kids and you know, young offenders, because I know exactly how they feel.
I'll come and give a talk.
Really?
No, I'll tell you something else. I'll do it for free. Just give a small donation to the National Trust.
Okay, well, all right, go on. So, you know, you've got 20 young offenders in front of you. You know, what do you say to them?
I take my jacket off.
No jacket required?
No, different from that. Very slowly, all eyes on me. Then I'd say, now listen up, bird brains, and listen good. If you're thinking of going out there to smack up crack or do some robbing, you'll have me to deal with. Right?
Well, that can work, you know.
I can't hear you! What's that? And then you answer me again loudly, both together in unison.
Right.
Good! Oh, yeah, found it. There it is. Sorry.
What for?
Because I trumped. What a nice man.
Yeah.
How refreshing.
Yeah.
Just... Hello?
Yeah.
I just told you how refreshing you are.
Cheers, thank you. This, you know what, I just realised I do actually have your phone. We must have the same phone.
Right, not a problem, yeah.
You must probably stole my one, eh, Alan?
It can happen that way around. It can.
Well, you know, you need to be careful. You know, I may be reformed and everything, but I still got a right hook.
Yeah, hey, shut up, you'll give you a bunch of fives.
Break it up!
That's definitely the right one, is it?
Yeah.
Yeah, check. Great, really great crack.
Richard.
Excellent. Cheers, mate.
Take care, bye-bye.
Okay, absolutely goodbye. Are you all right?
Yeah, fine. I've just done my back as I went back in and chair.
Okay, but we're cool.
Oh, yeah.
And today's dedication comes from the Allsop family. They say, Alan, please can you play Bright Eyes by Art Garfunkel in memory of our beloved Isabel, who died early this week, aged just 9. Oh, and is buried in the back...
Should always be referred to as it.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely, I couldn't agree. But, I mean, can you even bury humans in your back garden? I think
Fred West did.
Oh, that man. What a Dilbert. You're listening to
Colossal Questions,
formerly known as
Large Questions.
We're talking bathroom routines and asking, in what order do you perform your ablutions? We've got a text in from Helen in this. She says, I go to the toilet straight away, get rid of it as quickly as possible, and then I can enjoy my wash once empty. Makes a hell of a lot of sense. Helen, I'm with you on that one. On the line, we have Donald in King's Lynn.
Hi, Alan. I clean my teeth and shave while simultaneously going to the toilet in order to save time. Mm-hmm.
And then wash afterwards?
Yeah.
Good.
And Samuel in Yarmouth. I don't need a bath. I just crouch on a strong sink, and then it's teeth, face, pits, hands, then backside.
Neat. And here's a group who'd love a bit of face, hands and backside.
Are all your phone-ins like that?
Yeah, we cover a range of topics, but that's the tone we aim for.
Remarkable.
Thank you. Although that can have two meanings, can't it?
Yes, it can, yeah. It's up to you to choose.
Gold. Save it, though, save it. This is Midmaw Matt, and I'm excited to say that I'm joined by a man for the more outspoken end of the speaking spectrum. He's here to promote his new book, The Irascible, The Inimitable, The Incorrigible, Jasper Jones. You're often described as the attack dog of the anti-establishment, a kind of a lone wolf prowling the corridors of power.
So I'm a cross between a wolf and a dog.
Yeah.
A dolph.
Yeah, or a wog. Sorry, I take that back. Jasper is... very much, well, he's white. Now, Jasper's here to promote his new book. It's called Free Speech. He's got his sort of devil's tail sticking out of his shoulder there and a couple of horns. Is that because people think you're a bit controversial?
I presume so.
Right, but you must have had approval.
I did, yeah.
And the sort of tape over his mouth then. Presumably that's because to stop your mouth talking, because they'd like to shut you up.
Oh, they would love to shut me up.
They would, wouldn't they?
Yes. Yeah.
Who are they, by the way?
Well, they're the naysayers.
Right, that's okay. I didn't know. Okay.
There's your vanilla frothy coffee, Mr. Partridge.
Thank you, Angela.
Come on, I've got...
I've got to go back to the desk. Simon doesn't mind.
Fuck him.
I'll see you later.
Not if I see you first.
You drive me barmy.
Don't be silly.
Tell you what, if I was a dog right now, I'd be chewing a slipper. Now, you want to sell lots of copies, don't you?
Mm, yeah, well, assuming the placarded plebs don't run me out of town first.
Yeah, I used to dish out smackdowns to the fusspots.
It's bog standard naysaying from the usual crowd. If I could harness all that huffiness, I would start my own wind farm, I think.
That's good. I think you may have spoken over me there. I do love your withering put-downs, just sort of acerbic...
Maybe your next book should be called Withering Slights.
That's good. Sam's our sort of regional equivalent of you. He sort of takes a wry, sideways look at the week's news.
Does he?
Yeah. Yes. I can't do it the way he does it, or you do it. He sort of says things like, you know, I've heard of such and such, but this is ridiculous. Or, you know, putting him in charge of X is like putting someone silly in charge of Y. And there's another one.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'll just say, oh, if they're doing that today, then by tomorrow they'll be doing, you know, something daft.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, lovely stuff. Yeah. I mean, he's sort of Batman to my Robin. You wouldn't want Robin on his own. You know, if the people of Gotham were in trouble, they wouldn't call Robin, they'd phone the police. But Batman likes Robin, and I like Simon.
Yes, well, he's certainly not the Joker.
No, he's Robin. North Norfolk Digital. Yes, I'd like a compact excavator with a rotating platform and a knuckle boom. Yes, for the whole weekend. 360, please. Nope, just the tilting bucket. Well, that's okay, I won't require the driver. I'll be operating it. I know. No, I want to drive the digger. I'm aware of that. I'm going to be spending this weekend driving a digger. Now, Jasper, I've got a confession. I used to keep your book in the downstairs toilet.
Oh.
I was about two chapters in and I thought, this is not a toilet book.
So you moved it to the coffee table.
So I moved it to the coffee table.
Well, I'm flattered, Alan.
Yeah, quick spray of Dettol.
Well, I hope that wasn't because of the content.
No, it's for germs, because it had been... But what I love about it, what I love about you, is that you speak your mind, and it really is refreshing. It's like a big gulp of mouthwash or, you know, driving dead fast with all the windows down.
Right. Well, I'm of the view that there are certain truths that are self-evident, and so what is wrong with talking about them? The black community does have a problem with gun crime. Gay activism does upset some people.
Israelis are rude at airports.
I'm not sure about
Japanese people. Or Japanese people always take photos of signposts. What is that all about?
What are you asking us?
No, that's a joke.
All right. Hang on, they do, don't they? Yeah. What is all that about?
Maybe we should do a phone in.
No, we will do that definitely. Yeah. Okay, here's a guy who's got a mouth like a snare and a voice like a cat trapped in one. It's Shane McGowan and the Porgs. Love the glasses, by the way.
Thank you.
And the hair, although it looks messy, but it's actually quite hard, like you've put...
More of your text on bathroom routines. Enid in Docking says, anyone who claims they don't wee in the shower is a liar.
Oh, bolshy lady. And an email from Barbara in Dis. She says, when I'm sitting in the bath, people outside can see my head through the window. But when I stand, they could see my fanny. So I have a choice between drawing the curtain or crawling to the bath. The time is 40 years after the Battle of Hastings, 1106. Modison Holt, you want to take issue with Jasper?
Yeah, I mean, it's the knee-jerk rubbish he wrote about in the Bloody Sunday Inquiry.
Yeah, you hang around with terrorists and you might get shot.
His truth. Although Gerry Adams, to be fair, has softened as his beard's got greyer. When it was dark and thick.
So was he.
It normally does loads like that.
Well, you're just as bad, Alan, aren't you? Criticising the working class.
I bet he hates fracking. Probably always standing on picket lines.
Yeah, well, don't they all? Fingerless gloves around the brazier, spare me.
Yeah, striking.
And we indulge them.
Yeah, everybody out.
You know, everyone says, then shouldn't we try start arbitration? You know, that would be one way. The other way would be to take them outside and shoot them in front of their kids.
Ooh, he went there. Neil Dahlia, turn your head away. Turn your head away. And just empty the clipper to the back of his skull. And just silence. You know, just broken just by the, you know, the sound of the widow and his son quietly weeping. No, but they shouldn't strike.
I liked your book.
Well, don't nick anything.
Oh, I won't. I've got a little book of ideas. Just... Sorry.
That was Berlin with Take My Breath Away, which I'm dedicating to my partner Angela, who's got asthma. I'll tell you what takes my breath away, the number of calls and texts we've had about Jasper. It's not been like this since we had the chat about Ramadan. Although, on our message board, a few people have let themselves down with some pretty ugly vitriol.
There's a surprise.
Yeah, I won't go into detail, but lots of Fs, smattering of effing Cs, some D-heads... and various T's, and a couple of S for brains.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. Time once again for...
Shut up. Time once again...
Oh, thousand apologies.
...for our local hero of the week.
Sponsored by Benson and Hedges.
And you'll remember last week it went to Andy Deacon, a father of three who was on a school roof retrieving a football and found the body of a cat, which he returned to its owner very thoughtfully in a silk... lined shoebox.
Ah, once again, you've been calling with your tales of public spirit, heroism and daring do.
I'm sure it's what Alexander Graham Bell had in mind when he invented the telephone.
Good humour. Every week, we ask you, our listeners,
to put forward someone
in your life
as Andrew Neil,
who you feel is worthy of the title hero.
Opinions are like
it doesn't
bottoms.
Have to be hero in the
Everyone
traditional sense,
i.e.
a soldier in Iraq, but someone that you
hidden.
Feel has gone out of the way
Twitter
to do something for someone else. That's what we're looking
groups.
For. It really it does, is that
make
simple.
Make one crave a little bit of silence.
Unbelievable. Hello, June.
Hello.
It's Alan Partridge from North Norfolk Digital's Local Hero.
Sponsored by Benson and Hedges.
Who was that?
Your friend Maggie tells us that you've been recently knitting some luminous bibs for the car park attendants at your office.
Oh, I did, yeah.
Well, I'm pleased to say that you've been named as this week's local hero.
You? Nah, a hero.
Who was that?
By way of a prize, you should be able to see a man outside dressed as a clown with £100 cash in his pocket.
Oh. Is he smoking a cigarette?
He might be. Simon, who'd be your local hero?
Probably my news agent. At the end of the day, each day, he gives away all the leftover sandwiches to homeless people.
That's a hero.
He's a hero.
He's a hero. What about you, Jasper?
Oh, no, I couldn't possibly comment.
Oh, go on.
Well, I'll tell you who I wouldn't nominate.
No, we can all do that. Hitler, tell us who you would nominate.
Well, I've always admired...
Not someone who works in the media or London.
Yeah, God forbid, making one of them a hero would be like
don't
making...
Don't do one of those. Just tell us who's your hero.
Well, there was a history teacher at my school, Mr. Rigg.
No, so he might... Sorry.
No, you were saying.
No, please, do go on, I insist.
Just he'd be... he didn't have to take me under his wing and... he did. And he was very kind to me when I was... vulnerable, and I miss him. And I don't mind saying that.
You should talk more like that, because when you did, you could see in your face that, deep down, you're a cracking fella.
Hmm? Thank you.
Forget about it. Forget about it. Love that. Okay, time for some music. Here's a chap who's permanently high while his mates sell blubber for cash. It's Bob Marley and the Wailers. All the other kids with the pumped-up kicks. Better run. Outrun my gun. All the other kids with the pumped up kicks. Better run. Faster than my bullet. Is that better? Does that feel a bit better?
Yeah, a bit.
I hope that helps. I know you're... Yeah. You've got to talk to someone, yeah. Professional. It's not really... I'm not equipped for...
Singing for
you, Pippa. You really need to... the number's in the book, you know. So yeah. I'll talk to you. Call again soon. I'll always talk to you. Thanks a lot, love. Gotta go. Bye. You're listening to Mid-Morning Matters with Alan Partridge. Today is Valentine Day.
Alan. Oh, Alan.
Happy Valentine.
Without further ado, he's sitting right next to me. If I was blind, I'd know he was here, because being hungover as he is, he smells like a ruddy brewery staffed by tramps. None other than the Sidekick Simon.
Sidekick Simon.
Firstly, you stink.
Sidekick Simon.
Yep, I've got some dedications here, Alan. Andy would like to say hello to his darling wife, Beverly. They met 12 years ago in some woods. She was walking her dog and he was just looking for something. And they married very soon afterwards.
The time is 11:17. Sounds like an early 80s synth band. Heaven 17, you should have said that. Coming up, Jill Reynolds will be giving us both a good old-fashioned nosh. The local top chef will be preparing some Valentine's fare. I wonder what will be on the menu. Don't want to think about it.
No.
Goblins meat pud in a tin. Cold, eaten with a fork. Tinned goblins beef burgers in brine. Again, cold, eaten with a fork. Frey Bentos pie filling. No pie, just the filling. Eaten with a tablespoon. So you have to stretch your mouth to get it in. Semolina skins. Some warm, some cold. Eaten with a fork in a warm bathroom. This is the enormous Barry White singing a song about how he somehow makes love to a woman. Does not bear thinking about. Jill.
Valentine's Day. Unfortunately, not something the whole world can celebrate.
No, that's right, Alan. And if you're single on Valentine's Day, it can be very hard. But good food will always lift the spirits.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more. I think really the message is to anyone who is lonely out there, on a day like today, throw caution to the wind and eat yourself giddy. I think on Valentine's Day particularly, it would be a cold heart that wouldn't let you use food as a crutch.
Well, the thing is, Alan, it's called comfort food for a reason.
It is, it is. Although I would say that if you are going to do that, please do introduce roughage at some point along the way. Forward planning always pays off. You don't want the 15th to be an even more depressing day than the 14th. Although for me, it always is. Unfortunately, that's the day my ruddy dad died. So, yeah, but mixed feelings, so not all bad.
Well, a good plate of comfort food can really work one...
In a nutshell, you know, I got a bit of that, but I loved him, so...
a good plate of comfort food can do wonders for a broken heart, if not for the waistline.
Off. Let me ask you about comfort food. We've all been there. You come home from another god-awful day at work with people you hate. There's no one at home. The lights are all on. The sink's full of dishes. You flop down on the sofa. Don't even take your coat off. Who are you trying to impress? There's no one there. The TV's blaring out. You can't find the remote. It's been on ITV for a month. You're vaguely aware of some policeman talking to a drunk teenager with a blurry face, and you think, so help me God, I need to be comforted by food. What do you cook?
Fried egg sandwiches. Yeah. 3 fried eggs on Mother's Pride white bread with lots of butter.
Huh, all right. Hey, you're a chef, right?
Yeah, but even chefs need comforting.
Yeah, all right.
Alan, can I ask you something?
You may.
What makes you feel sexy?
Sitting in a leather chair in my underpants.
No, I mean food-wise.
Oh, blue cheese.
Because for a lot of people, it means Italian food, the food of love. Oh. And so today, I'm going to be making a dish from Naples.
Oh. Nipples.
What? Staggering. He was out on the town last night.
No, I wasn't.
Of course you were.
I wasn't. I was at home. I was drinking wine.
Where'd you live? A drop-in centre?
Back off! I'm having a tough time at the moment.
There's traffic and truffle. Yeah.
Traffic and travel, sponsored by Castrol.
Alan, can I just use the loo?
What for? I mean, yeah, sure. Just use the disabled. He's only in on Wednesdays. They designed the whole building around him. I think he was some sort of evil genius. He's not. Just knows a lot about jazz. Lynn, I haven't got Angela a Valentine's present, so you've got until noon to scour Norfolk for a competitively priced baby doll nightie. That's exactly what I said, Lynn. Then wrap a bow on it and put it in bubble wrap. And I know it won't smash, Lynn. Just wrap it in bubble wrap! To recap, that's 3 wagon wheels, a whole pack of butter into a pan of hot PG tips, defrost an Aunt Bessie's Yorkshire pud, pour in the solution quickly, take some broken Easter eggs, I got mine around the back of Roundtree Macintosh, smear it down the circumference, add the Jaffa lid, boom, you've got yourself a giant Rolo.
Well, I do admire your creativity, Alan, I really do, and you know, I like a man who likes his puds.
Off. Who's hungry?
I am famished. Please,
give me something to eat.
Please, give me something. I need some food. I've got malnutrition.
I love that. I offered it to Comic Relief. They didn't want it. Their loss. Anyway, time for our Valentine gobble-off. What you got, Jill?
It's a dish that's very popular in the southern part of Italy. Right. And it's linguine con sarde, which is linguine
with something.
Sardines.
Precisely. Fish pasta, but with the fish being, in this instance, sardines.
Yeah.
Got it.
So we take our lovely fresh sardines. We've also got pine nuts, red chilies, fennel and onion.
OK, we'll do without the fennel because I don't like fennel and I don't want fennel in it.
Oh, I wouldn't have put you down as a fussy eater, Alan.
Just don't like fennel.
No, but honestly, you won't notice it, but it makes all the difference. It just lifts the whole thing.
If you put fennel in there, they're going to fall out.
OK. So, first of all, we're going to chop up our red chilies and our onions. Some people have them ready chopped, but we're not going to do that. We're going to chop them ourselves.
Simon, when you snapped before, the reason I didn't slap you is because I'm concerned.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm just feeling a bit down at the moment.
What you down for, buddy Bill? When I first met you in that pub, and you were coming up with funny words for a woman's period, I was on the floor. And just as I tried to get up, you capped it all off with your penguin walk. Where's that guy gone? Where's penguin period man gone?
Literally, I just feel a bit down at the moment, to the point where I almost didn't.
Why don't you go and sit in my car?
Okay.
There's half a double-decker in the glove box. It's yours. There's an unopened crunchy. I'd ask you to leave that. I'm driving to Banbury later.
Thanks.
Ask your butcher where the lamb's sourced from. I'll ask your butcher if the mince is sustainable. I'll ask your butcher the best way to bone a carcass. Leave the guy alone. If he was good with people, he wouldn't be a butcher.
I know what you mean, love. I mean, some of these top celebrity chefs, they just try too hard. Simple, uncomplicated food is the best.
Yeah.
Do you know what my favourite food is?
Faggots.
No, a good pie.
Mine too.
There you are.
I love a good pie.
And what would be your favourite filling, your dream filling, your ideal filling?
Do you mean food stuff?
Not necessarily. What were you thinking of?
Julia Bradbury.
Ooh. Oh, the TV presenter.
Yeah, the presenter of Country File and Canal Walks and Wainwright's Walks and other shows. I put her in a big oven. I wouldn't want to break her up. I'd baste her with hot butter, using the empty butter pack as a kind of a cream glove. Yeah. And then pop on a pastry lid, 2 hours on a low heat. Done. Add chopped cabbage.
How did you come up with that idea?
I don't know. I have this dream where Julia and I are walking along a Lakeland fell when the heavens open, and I've lost my compass, literally, and we don't know which direction to go in, so we have to pitch this tent, which we crawl inside, cuddle each other, and start crying. And then, and I have to be honest with you, Jill, we have a kiss.
A Julia Bradbury pie. Well, that's a new one on me. You're like Heston Blumenthal there with his egg and bacon ice cream.
I am like Heston Blumenthal. Heston Blumenthal. I'm going to take the egg and bacon and cross them meat and ice cream. But sir, that is not natural. Silence! The experiments will begin at dawn. Soon we will have an ice cream which will rule the menu for 1,000 years. Heston Blumenthal neither endorses nor is affiliated with extreme right-wing groups or their activities. Apologise for any connotations there. That's fair enough. OK, this is side two of Mike Oldfield, Tubular Bells. See you in 20 minutes. Right, I'm off for a shower. Jill, thanks ever so much for coming in. You've given me food, and you've given my listeners food for thought. Bye, Norfolk. That was great. Lovely. Really.
Oh, thank you. And I do hope that one day you get your walk with Julia Bradbury.
I think that's unlikely after what I said on air.
Oh, no, surely not.
I think she would want... She would only probably countenance it with a group of ramblers, or at the very least, sort of heavy supervision.
Look what the cat dragged in.
Hiya.
Hello. Hi. Everything all right?
Yeah. Just had a bit of a cry, but boo-hoo.
Yeah, no, I'm in the car, but...
Yeah, no, that's fine.
Yeah, right. And you're good. I mean, you don't have to talk about it.
Well, my girlfriend has been texting her ex, and I know that they were friends before they went out, and so they had the... She says that they're friends, so she
when
should
be... When you get upset, what you should try and do is bottle it up. In the short term, at least. I mean, you're not a member of a gun club, are you?
No.
No, great, yeah, we'll just bottle it up. And when you find an appropriate venue, let off steam. I go to Thetford Forest once every other Sunday and scream myself a horse.
At a horse?
No, I scream myself hoarse. I have screamed at a horse, but that was for a different thing.
Bye.
Don't cry. Nobody likes a crybaby. Women like a real man who doesn't take any shit. So pull yourself together and be a fucking man. Ta-ra.
Bye. That was weird.
What's the fish pasta like?
It's missing something.